Welcome everyone to the third meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee of 2022. I've received no apologies for this meeting's this morning's meeting. The first item on the agenda is for us all to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We are agreed, thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session as part of our short inquiry into health and wellbeing of children and young people. This session will focus on health and wellbeing in schools and education, and I welcome to the committee this morning Dr. Josie Booth, the Senior Lecturer in Developmental Psychology at the University of Edinburgh, Mike Corbett, National Official for NASUWT, Judy Edwards, Service Manager for Stirling Council, Kevin Kane, Policy and Research Manager for YouthLink Scotland, and Jacqueline Lynn, the Head of School and Community Sport for Sports Scotland. Now, just a bit of housekeeping first. The clerks have allocated one member to lead questioning on specific areas we want to cover this morning. If any other member wishes to ask a supplementary question on anything, you can use the chat box and put an R in it. If I have time, I'll come to you. And with regard to our panellists, I'll do a bit of a round robin of the panellists to get their initial views, but if members can direct their questions to individuals, and if other panellists want to come in and add to that, you can also use the chat box just to flag it up that you want to come in to me and I'll come to you. So I really want to ask around the panel and ask about, you know, schools are often seen as, you know, they've got contact with the children and young people for, you know, however many hours of the day, for five days a week. Obviously, pre-pandemic, it was always physical, and there were no restrictions on that. And we will come on to COVID with some questions from our colleagues later specifically. But to what degree are our schools in a position to intervene early on the issues that of well-being that pupils may have, and promote health and well-being within that school week? And I know it will be a varying picture throughout the country, given that obviously local authorities are in charge of education in each part of the country. But if I can go around the panel and just get your varying thoughts about the position that schools are in to do that, and any issues there. Can I go to Dr. Josie Booth?
Hi there, good morning, and thank you for inviting me along this morning. And so your question, Julie, about schools being in a position to support positive mental health and wellbeing. And I think one of the key challenges is that schools lack resources, and teachers often lack training, both pre-service and in-service. So while they are acting as teachers, and they don't really have the support in order to promote positive health and well-being. And one of the key challenges for teachers is that their own health and well-being is perhaps not optimal as well. And so they need to be supported in order to be at the forefront of helping children and young people to develop positive health and well-being, as well as support those young people where there might be challenges.
Dr. Booth, well, I've got you just there. I mean, you mentioned that teachers don't have the mental health training, and they don't. But there has been a bit of an intervention, although it's early days, and having school counsellors available to every school. Do you see that as being an important intervention?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think anything that can be done at the moment is really positive. I think at Moray House, we work with a mental health charity, Place to Be, to support student teachers when they're developing their skills, so that then when they go into the service, they feel more equipped. And even while they're on placements, they have some support. However, this is not across all training capacity. And it's true for when teachers are actually in service that they don't have the support as well. And they're having to support many pupils with sometimes very complex challenges to their health and well-being. And they need to have the resources and the support in order to do that. And we know that CAMHS have very lengthy waiting lists and are really at capacity. And really, schools are at the forefront of supporting pupils even before they get to CAMHS, but also while they're on those waiting lists both for assessment but also for treatment, and then maybe after they've had a diagnosis as well. Schools are the ones really supporting young people. So we need to have whole systems approaches for doing this. So we need to be able to support young people, their families, but schools working with CAMHS and across the whole system really to develop positive change.
Thank you. And can we come to Mike Corbett?
Hi. Yeah. I mean, I would say that historically, obviously, schools have been in an excellent position to help young people and to help them with their mental health and well-being. That's from class teachers with their day-to-day contact, through well-established guidance and pastoral systems, often very good, you know, personal and social education. So, you know, that has always been there. But I think historically as well, schools and teachers have often felt that many things have just been left to them, and there's not necessarily been, you know, more outside help. So, for example, you touched there on, you know, the expansion of school counsellors, which is obviously a very, very good thing. I think the other thing that I would touch on, as well as, you know, a lack of resources, which has already been mentioned, is, you know, teachers at the moment feel under enormous pressure. Many of them, you know, have suffered physically and mentally during the pandemic. And so they're sometimes not in an optimum position to give what they used to give to their pupils. So they feel under enormous amount of pressure. So again, I think, you know, more support is needed there for the workforce, which then can help the pupils themselves.
Yeah, thank you. Can I come to Judy Edwards?
Good morning. I would say that schools are well placed to support children and young people with health and well-being. And at the moment, certainly in the authority that I work within, mental health and well-being is a top priority for us. And I would agree with my panel members in that that's not just for children and young people. Our staff well-being is also a priority for us, and we are endeavouring to support our staff best we can through this really challenging time. I agree that training and resources can always be improved, and it's, I think, given that health and wellbeing is one of the three key areas of the curriculum, it's not unusual that we would strive to do that. But at this time, the landscape has changed slightly because of the pandemic, and we certainly are in a position to be seeking to improve resources and training, and also to strengthen our partnership working to support the challenges that we have.
Judy, can I ask you, did your local authority, did you see schools ever using like PEF money to provide that extra support within particular schools?
Absolutely. Most schools would be using PEF money to support health and wellbeing in some way. And of course, some additional funding that's come to schools in terms of COVID recovery, that has also been most welcome to also support this area of the curriculum and others.
Okay, thank you. Can I come to Kevin Kane?
Hiya. It's a fantastic question to open on. So thanks for tabling something so significant so early in the committee session. Any focus on wellbeing in schools needs to consider the role of other practitioners in supporting wellbeing and bringing about the best outcome for the young person in schools. Worth noting that not every young person's experience of school takes place in a classroom or even a school building, and without youth workers, far too many young people wouldn't be in school. And we have reams of quotes from young people who've said exactly that. As committee members will know, there's a curriculum review ongoing. One of our recommendations is that there needs to be a refreshed narrative of the definition of the curriculum. Youth work is education, but it's very often described as education and then youth work. We also want to ensure that the education system is as inclusive as it possibly can be, and youth work practitioners can help us deliver that in the school, around the school, after school. Now, a couple of good examples here. St Mungo's Academy in Fair Scotland, they worked in partnership across the school setting The focus was on building long-term relationships with young people, supported their wellbeing, skills, achievement, and it included sessions on children's rights, leadership, and open discussions and peer-led training sessions on wellbeing. It was the headline stat for the committee is that 84% of the participants described improvements in their health and wellbeing. Another example, Scouts Scotland, so we're seeing voluntary and local authorities working together here, and Kirkcaldy High School, they used outdoor adventure days to support enhanced transition between S1 and S2 pupils and those primary 7 pupils that missed out residentials due to COVID. More than 500 young people benefited, and the key thing again for this committee is that they all said they'd improved physical, mental health and wellbeing as a result of those experiences. So as I was preparing for the committee, I was thinking, can you imagine what the transformative impact a project like that could be if we scaled it up on a national level? Now, we have to pay some homage to the Youth Work Education Recovery and Outdoor Learning funds. They've been fantastic. They've brought together practitioners under the umbrella of getting the best out of a young person in a manner that suits them. And there's just two final points to make that we've seen across several years of the Scottish Attainment Programme, that it isn't one service or one practitioner alone, but effective collaboration across the system, which better supports young people. So we believe that we need to continue this shared vision, capture the best of what was a chaotic situation, but we saw such innovative approaches and we saw youth workers to the fore and carry this forward into the future. And the last thing is that there's an ongoing issue of youth workers accessing facilities, and this needs addressed imminently, otherwise it will preclude or severely limit the services that are available to young people. Our message from the sector is that there's still a lot of variability of access to premises. So I would ask the committee to work alongside your colleagues and cross-party and even with the government to address this, because if it's not resolved, it will continue to impact negatively on the development of young people, and especially so for those who are already in a deprived position. And we know that COVID has increased inequality. There was an Oxfam report to that effect just recently. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You flagged up quite a lot of things. I think transition in particular is something that we're acutely aware of, has been a particular issue. And that's great to hear of that example from Kirkcaldy, where they've had collaboration to jump in and help give those young people the kind of outdoor activities that they missed out on with the residential residential programmes been taken away with them because of lockdown. So thank you for flagging that up. Can I come finally to Jacqueline Lynn?
Good morning, everyone. Nice to be here, and thank you very much for the invite today. Just, I think it's a great question as well, Gillian, in terms of all of that. And I believe, and we believe at Sport Scotland, that schools play a significant role in the wellbeing of children, recognising that it is a challenge for all the things they have to do. As Sport Scotland, it's our ambition that we get more people taking part in sport, and particularly children and young people, to make sure they have an active and healthy lifestyle as they work through the different stages of school. We work across the 32 local authorities, the Leisure Trust, to really make sure that sport and physical activity is at the heart of school. We have an active schools network, sports development network and community sport hubs that provides opportunities for children and young people before school, lunchtime and after school, with a real clear connection to physical education and the link to the curriculum for excellence in health and wellbeing. And that whole PPAS agenda is really, really important to everyone. And I think what that does is shows the partnership working, that we work with the local authority, leisure trusts, our governing bodies and third sector to really have that whole systems approach to the health and wellbeing of children. I think we recognise that it's been a challenge over the pandemic. Before the pandemic, we had over 320 individual young people taking part in active schools, you know, in their school environment, sometimes in their community. And we're just waiting in some of the evidence to see what that looks like as the restrictions are easing back. But as part of the pandemic, and I think it's really important to recognise here, you know, there was a flexibility in active schools and community support hubs, officers and sports development, and they just worked locally in the childcare hubs and making sure they got food parcels to families and really whatever was needed in the communities. And I think that's really helped strengthen relationships around different practitioners that perhaps active schools, sports development hubs didn't have. So I think there's a real opportunity here for us to work as the national agency with local partners, with schools and a whole range of other local and third sector partners to really make sure the health and wellbeing of our children are at the heart of this and we make sure they recover positively.
And Jacqueline, you mentioned there that you don't quite have the evidence of how strongly it's coming back. That's something that obviously you're monitoring to see as we're coming in, hopefully, into the endemic phase of this.
Yep, yep, and we will have that. We're just looking at term one in the stats and we're just waiting on the final stats coming out and that will, we'll let people know that and we'll work with the local partners on that. Yep.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go to my colleagues now and I'm just checking we've got Stephanie Callaghan. Stephanie, are you there?
Yes, I am, Gillian. I'm not sure if there's a wee problem with my camera there.
We can't see you, but we can hear you and that's the main thing.
Okay, well, when I've done my question, I'll come off and come back in and hopefully that'll improve things there. Morning panel, really good to have you here with us today. We've already heard mentioned that physical wellbeing is really vital in the role of our mental health and wellbeing there. So my question is, how well have universal interventions worked, such as targets for PE, but also free school meals, access to school counsellors, how well have they supported health and wellbeing outcomes for our young people? And if I could ask that to Judy, please.
Thank you for your question. They have absolutely supported our young people. And I think it'll be widely known and recognised by this book, the importance of if children are fed and are well nourished, then they're in a better place to learn. So absolutely, that has made a difference. In terms of universal supports, I think the ongoing challenge is there's just never quite enough. It was mentioned earlier about the benefit of, for example, our PPAS work and what we are at a local level. We are certainly aware of the growing gap between, we had focused on trying to get those most inactive active and a real focus on girls in sport, and we're certainly hearing evidence now from our schools and nurseries that that gap is growing and that the impact on young people's wellbeing as a result of the lack of support, the lack of our ability to have the extracurricular programme that we had, to have the support services in schools to support our young people is having an impact. And we are working with our schools and nurseries to look at creative ways to continue as best we can. And obviously, as restrictions relax, we are currently discussing how we work to get our extracurricular programme, for example, back up and running, and have our volunteers, our sports leaders back across their schools supporting that work.
And Dr. Bruce would like to come in. Just your microphone live, if we can.
Thank you. Hopefully you can hear me now. As I said, one of the issues that we know in Scotland is that we lack nationally representative data about the health and wellbeing of our young people. So the Active Healthy Kids report card that was published last year said that there was inconclusive data to report on many of the health challenges that we've got. So, for example, they weren't able to report on factors such as fitness, diet and obesity because we don't have nationally collected data that's actually representative of our population. So we know that prior to the pandemic, so their health and wellbeing was amongst some of the lowest in Europe. And we know from studies in other countries that those health factors have decreased and the gap is exacerbated due to COVID. However, we don't know a real representative picture in Scotland. So I think that's one of the challenges at the moment, is that we think things have got worse, but we don't really know. We have small studies that collected data, but we don't have anything nationally representative in either our physical health or the mental health and wellbeing of young people.
Thank you. And I'll come to Kevin Kane.
I'll be as quick as I can with this one. Just to say that youth workers tell us repeatedly that they want to be part of a holistic approach to wellbeing. And in advance of this session, I managed to get a really good example of this in practice from Shetland Island Council, involving two high schools and the Mind Your Head Mental Health Charity. They provided two additional youth workers to increase youth work provision in school and the wider community. It focused on social, emotional and mental health and connected issues such as attendance. 1,481 young people accessed support through workshops, and this included one-to-one support for young people with complex needs. All of the young people who accessed the service, and this is going to be a bit of a theme today, said they felt they had improved health and well-being. So you can see that there is a bit of magic that happens when you bring together knowledge and learning from across a wide variety of services who are collaborating around the core aim of improving the health and well-being of young people. But right in the middle of all of that is the principle of universality, but not just when it comes to mental health and well-being, but taking a universal approach to youth work. It's so impactful on all the areas that we're discussing today.
Thank you. And can I come to Jacqueline Lynn?
Thank you very much. I think it would be fair to say that universal interventions do work. I think there's certainly room for improvement, but if we just continue to build on that whole school approach to the PPAS agenda, where it is about physical education, physical activity and sport, and how do we get the teachers and the active school coordinators, sports development coaches, the youth workers working together to have the child at the centre and making sure the physical and mental wellbeing is there. We know from evidence that we've got back from active schools is that 98% of the children involved in the active school programmes feel healthier because they make friends, it does help their wellbeing. We also know that the leadership programmes that Judy mentioned around young ambassadors and a whole variety of leadership programmes give the young people the chance to have their voice at the heart of that, drive that and look at how that can support. One other thing that we've worked across the last few years is our young people sport panel, so that we have a national platform that allows them to look at what is the voice of the young person, what do they need, and they're very clear that accessibility and having the young person's voice and valued and making sure that sport and physical activity is at the heart. So there's a lot of those interventions there. I think there's always room for improvement in the sectors working together in this partnership approach to really make sure the young person, and particularly around inclusion, that we can really have a targeted approach. Through the pandemic, we found that some of the areas, because of the work of active schools, particularly in Renfrewshire and Aberdeenshire, have been given additional resource because of the work that they've actually had with young people throughout the pandemic. So there's good examples that we could actually show where quality work is taking place.
Thank you. And I'll come to Mike Corbett.
Yes, thanks. Certainly on the universal free school meals, or that principle of universality on free school meals, we don't think there's any doubt that is helpful and improves matters. And there's certainly some research evidence around to show that. I think on the physical activity side, we would evidence seems to be a bit more anecdotal there, and I'd certainly echo Dr. Booth's point about, you know, we could perhaps have more research on that side, but certainly what we have seen suggests that helps, but it would be good to have a wider picture on that, I think.
Thank you. Stephanie, do you want to come back and ask anything specifically?
Yeah, that would be great. Thank you, convener. Some really comprehensive answers there, I think. Very interesting and worthwhile interventions. I suppose really you're all leading me on to my next question there, which is how are health and wellbeing outcomes being measured? So how can we as policymakers as well evaluate that impact in the preventative approaches and the early interventions that you're talking about here today? Thanks.
And who would you like to direct that to?
Initially, if I could direct that to Judy again, thanks.
Thank you, Judy.
The assessment of health and wellbeing is challenging, and we are hoping that the census, the current health and wellbeing census, is going to help us with that. But health and wellbeing is being assessed within schools in terms of looking at the assessment approaches within Curriculum for Excellence and obviously tracking and monitoring children's progress through the levels of the curriculum. Sometimes it's difficult, as was mentioned earlier, if we're thinking about, for example, the impact that sport has on other aspects of a young person's development, it's quite difficult to actually evidence that that's what's made the difference. But schools take a holistic approach to assessment, and it's trying to bundle some of the E's and O's together to then gather evidence. So going back to the first statement that I made, it's challenging to assess health and wellbeing, but it is something that schools are doing as part of their core work.
Can I just follow that up, Judy, and ask, is there a need then for more qualitative data? Is there anything specific that you would be looking for there?
As I said earlier, it's difficult sometimes to evidence. If we're talking about mental health and wellbeing, it's sometimes quite difficult to measure that and to apportion where the improvements have been made and what made those improvements. So I think that when I talked earlier also about the census, I think we're going to be able to gather good data from the census, more data and good data from the census to help us improve our programme and curriculum and where the gaps are and what better support is needed. And that will then help with our assessment of the curriculum. We also mentioned earlier about resources and training, and I think that further staff development and training around assessment and health and wellbeing would be most welcome. And for example, we're working collaboratively within our regional improvement collaborative, looking at recreational drugs and how do you assess that area of our work. But in collaboration with partners, we're certainly trying to find a way through that. And the more resources, the more support from partners, for example, our health colleagues, is supporting us to do that.
Thank you, Judy.
Can I come to Dr. Booth first?
Thank you. I would echo those sentiments about the challenges of actually determining health and wellbeing. How do we measure that? We know that for some populations, measuring mental health is really challenging. So there's a study recently done in Scotland with young people and neurodiverse young people. So there's a large group of children with autism, and the rates of depression varied hugely from nothing to 83%. And it seemed to be due to the way that was being measured. So we know that some of the existing ways of measuring mental health difficulties don't always actually give a representative picture of the challenges, really. And I think this probably speaks to this whole system and holistic view again, that we can't really tease apart the impact of some of these interventions on physical health and mental health, because the two are intricately related. We know that our physical health will support and be preventative and also beneficial for our mental health. But we know that our mental health is really important for helping us undertake positive physical health. So, for example, we are unlikely to want to take part in sport and extra activity if our mental health is really challenged. So the two are really intricately related, and we need to have a holistic view when we're thinking about mental health, both physical and mental health and well-being, and how we even measure that and try to determine the impact is really quite important. And this is why we need to have this whole systems approach. So bringing schools and families and CAMHS and health professionals together in order to be able to look at this. So we do need more qualitative data, as you're asking, but we also need more quantitative data to really be able to look at a representative picture. So we know which groups of young people are more resilient, where there are particular risk factors, in order for us to be able to support these young people as best we can.
Thank you. I'll come to Mike Corbett before I bring one of my other colleagues in for a quick supplementary. Mike?
Thanks. Obviously, along with numeracy and literacy, health and wellbeing is one of the responsibilities for all teachers to review and assess. But as others have said, that is a challenge here. You know, it's not a percentage. It's not as simple to measure. And I think, consequently, there's probably not quite as much confidence amongst some teachers in what the actual standards are, or the expectations in terms of the assessment of progress of, for example, mental health. So we have been looking for some time for additional support from Education Scotland in terms of, you know, establishing a standard. But I do think there's an opportunity here because we do have a forthcoming review of assessment, which obviously the headlines have been all about national qualifications, but that is going to be a review of broader assessment in curriculum for excellence. And this seems to me one of the key areas that we need to dig down into and get a bit more support in terms of the understanding of how we can actually measure these things and give a bit more confidence.
Thank you. Paul Kane wants to come in.
Thank you, convener, and thanks to the panel. We've spoken there about universal intervention, but also the importance, I think, of knowing young people and getting the data right. I was quite struck by reading that 15-year-old girls continue to be the group with the lowest wellbeing scores. But maybe just keen if we've got a bit of time to explore the factors driving that, and indeed, do panellists feel that tackling gender inequality across policy areas is something that we absolutely have to do in order to make a difference? And I don't know if perhaps Dr. Booth maybe wants to say something about that.
Thank you. Yeah, I think one of the issues is that it's a multifaceted problem, if you like. So we know that the physical health issues are exacerbated often during that transition period, but we know that some of the decline in physical activity happens even earlier than the start of secondary school. So some large data studies show that even 7 or 8 year old children see a decline in their physical activity levels and an increase in sedentary behaviour. So we know that transition is important, and we know that transition from primary to secondary is also marked often with decreases in mental health, and often for girls especially. But we know that this is it's across the board, if you like. So it's not just girls, although I think a lot of the data highlights girls in particular. And it's not just due to physical health. We have mental health challenges. There's a wide range of contributing factors. So in the evidence we submitted, we were talking about the fact that bullying, social media, expectations, lack of support all contribute to mental health challenges and lack of physical activity. And it's, again, I feel like I'm saying the same thing. It's about this whole systems approach, because we know that if we want to encourage our young people to be more physically active, for example, it's not just about what they do in school. It's also what they do out of school, not only through taking part in sports, but things like active commuting. And if we don't have good infrastructure, then young people aren't going to cycle or walk to school. They're not going to go and be physically active out of school. And then they're similarly not going to do the same during break times and things like this. So there's a number of programmes looking to try and look at this whole system. And that might particularly support young girls, especially. There's a charity that aims to support young girls in terms of just providing infrastructure where young girls feel safe to be active. So good lighting, safe spaces where they feel more able to be outside and to be moving around. And all of these things will work together. So your question is about inequality. And I think that, yes, there is gender inequality, but I think also it's an issue across all of our young people.
Thank you. Thanks, Paul, for bringing that up. It's a really fascinating topic, and it's something that we have heard testimony from young people about, particularly girls being put off physical activity as they get into their teenage years. Can I come quickly to Kevin Kane?
Thank you. Just to echo some of those comments on poverty and inequality, we know that exacerbates a number of issues for women in this country and globally. So that's an issue that needs tackled in its own right, absolutely. But it's symptomatic of structural issues as well, which are at the root of a lot of those issues, is poverty. That's the first point. On the discussion about enhanced focus on community-based support, youth workers identify and tailor responses to young people's needs all the time. Not come as a surprise to the committee that I'm arguing the case, but it's an easy case to argue because they do it all the time. So they would look at the issue for a woman in the context of her world and the social environment and family environment that she's in. Interestingly, youth workers in North Lanarkshire told us during the initial lockdown that they'd never had more demand to work with parents and young mothers and families as they did in the initial phases of lockdown. They were able to pivot into that space because they're used to working around bureaucracy, breaking down barriers, being innovative, and they're also trusted in the community as well. We have examples from our food insecurities pilot, where the youth work approach helped break down the barriers to engaging with the whole family, to the point that the relationship building became as crucial, possibly even the primary motivator for people to get involved rather than the food provision. So the access to support was actually secondary, and that also has a really destigmatising effect on people as well. And just very quickly, more broadly, at the first committee session, there was talk of children's strategic partnerships, which recognise the need to pool resources and taking an asset-based approach to building community capacity. Youth workers are promoting this approach right now with an understanding that the young person's well-being within the context of their situation is fundamental.
Thank you. And can I come to Jacqueline Lynn before moving on to Bandesh Gohani?
Yeah, probably two things. One, on the data first, we did undertook research in 1920 around the contribution of the active schools to the Active Scotland Outcomes Framework, and we got over 9,000 respondents to that across 10 local authorities. And what we found in that, we know the numbers of, you know, the 320,000 young people, 7 million visits, 23,000 volunteers, 100 activities, but the more important bit was that qualitative stuff around the young people feeling healthier, the young people making friends, but also the young people feeling a bit more confident to then go out with the school and participate in clubs and activities in their communities. So I think there's some opportunity there. And again, it does go back to that whole school approach to physical education, physical activity and sport. And then just going on around the whole girls and women, that has been a challenge for all of us. And how do we work together to do that? We know through the participation in active schools that that continues to be a drop-off point. But where we have been working locally was putting in interventions with speaking to girls, a number of girls committees across the country, Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire, where there's amazing work that's really going on to the girls who are really working in the PPAS agenda with the PE teachers, with active schools, to change the curriculum, to revisit the environments they're in, and to really put what the girls and young women want at the forefront rather than that traditional PE, you know, curriculum that you either loved or loathed when you were at school yourself. So I think there are interventions. There's still a long way to go. But I think, again, if we can have this collaborative approach across education, sport, you know, health, then we can really make a difference for our girls and young women in this as well.
Great. Thank you. Can I move on to questions on COVID-19 from Sandesh?
Thank you, convener. So COVID has had a massively negative impact on the mental health of our children. From missing school to lockdown, it's led to a fourfold increase in mental health wellbeing issues. I note Inclusion's mission stated there's a lack of evidence for how school-based interventions lead to a reduction in health and wellbeing inequalities. And Dr. Booth, your submission says you feel teachers need to be clear to concentrate on their core responsibilities of teaching. So, Dr. Booth, my question is, what should we do to improve our children's wellbeing and mental health?
That's a very big question. What should we do to improve it? As we were saying in some submission, again, and others have said today, it's about this whole system working together. So schools and teachers are at the forefront of supporting children and young people, and we know that teachers need to also have good training, as I said earlier, but also support for their own mental health and wellbeing, because if they are overly stretched and overly burdened, then they can't support young people to the best of their abilities. We also know that as we said, they're inextricably linked factors, so we need to support our physical health as well as our mental health. And if we want to close the attainment gap, we also need to prioritise health and wellbeing, because our children aren't going to learn well if they're not healthy and mentally well. So we need to listen to young people and find out what their views of the challenges is and where they feel support is necessary. And there's been a number of studies, so the James Lind Alliance and also the Triumph study have been looking at young people's voices and finding out what their perspectives are and what they think are the real drivers here, not only for understanding where the problems are, but also how best to support them. One of the strategies we think is important is taking cross-diagnostic views. So rather than the traditional approach that is often has to be followed through CAMHS of thinking about children who might have particular areas of difficulty, looking across a particular child's difficulties. So seeing the individual young person and thinking about where their own challenges are and how we can support them on an individual basis. So we need these whole school approaches for supporting positive health and wellbeing rather than just reacting when there's challenges. So we need to increase our physical health. We need support for positive strategies, if you like, for our young people so that when they encounter a challenge, they can show their resilience because they're not able to be resilient always if their mental health is challenged. Thank you.
Can I bring in Mike Corbett?
Yes, thanks. Before I go on to talk about mental health, I mean, I don't think we should forget about the impact on the physical health of some pupils and the fact that, you know, some are suffering from long COVID. And indeed, at the moment, the key group where cases are still rising is primary school aged children. So there may still be further physical impacts for pupils. And that obviously causes difficulties for them in terms of absence and for teachers, you know, ensuring that they have the ability to catch up when you return or if they're able to do remote learning. So all of that adds pressure to teachers as well and to their workloads. So there's a lot going on there already before we consider mental health of pupils and how that might be supported and improved. I do think that there's still room for a more comprehensive approach to researching what exactly the issues are before we decide what the responses can be. So, for example, in the USA and the Netherlands in particular, they seem to have committed quite significant funding on research and evidence gathering, you know, developing questionnaires, carrying out diagnostic assessments to try and identify what are the actual issues for pupils across the board. And then they are deciding what to do in response to that. So does that mean we need small group tuition for some pupils? Does that mean we need improved reading comprehension support for some? With others, where it's mental health, is there additional social and emotional support needed? Do some need improved access to technology if they are off with long COVID? So it's a huge question to answer, but I do think that rather than, I mean, Dr. Beard talked about whole school approaches, and I think many things have been left to individual local authorities, and they are doing good work. But I do think there needs to be more of a national approach, first of all, in terms of gathering the evidence and then formulating the strategies and getting the appropriate resourcing behind that to try and help pupils.
Thank you. Sandesh, would you like to come back in?
Yes, please, Convener. So, I mean, Mike just spoke about physical health there, and we are in an obesity crisis here in Scotland with a 6.8% increase in primary one children at risk of being overweight in 1 year. And COVID has undoubtedly had an impact on this. But the Observatory for Sport Scotland tells us that general sport activity has been reducing from the age of 11 upwards. There's an understanding that council-owned sporting infrastructure may be too expensive for inclusive engagement. So I wanted to ask Jacqueline Lynn, how do we combat this worrying trend as our current policies do not quite seem to be tackling it?
Jacqueline.
That is a great question, and in terms of where we are, we recognise that challenge is there, and as what's happened in the pandemic, then the gap between the children and young people that can afford to take part in sport and physical activity has widened. So how do we create that, you know, opportunity for all children and young people? I guess for us it is then around where we work, and I'll keep going back to the PPAS agenda, to the physical education, which is the right of every child in school. There's a network of teachers there to do that. The active school coordinators are there. The opportunities in the schools, after schools, in that safe environment for children. The pandemic stopped that, but the active school network and the children are trying to do that. As the restrictions ease, we want to get that back on up and running so that children and young people have the opportunity to do that. the challenge for us is how do they continue that all in terms of into their life and the club environment and where we go into the community, then it's a challenge because there's a cost to that. And that is a problem for the sector, how we actually have to pay for that and how children and young people have to pay for that. But we'll keep going back to that whole systems approach and that collaborative approach. If we can work together, then we've got more chance of helping, but we can't do that in isolation. And we know as Sport Scotland, from a sport and physical activity, we've got a contribution, but we need to be working with Education Scotland around the whole agenda there. We need to be working with Public Health Scotland, and we've just recently signed a partnership agreement with them around these 8 investments for physical activity and how we can have a whole systems approach to general health and wellbeing, and then that whole school approach to them. And then finally, transport. I think the infrastructure is really important as well. Active schools have had walking buses for many years, but you know that still kids get dropped off in cars. How do we make the streets safe and how do we use that infrastructure? So I think, like most, it's about us working collaboratively with Scottish Government, with COSLA, local government, Community Leisure UK Scotland, really all pulling together so that we can provide lots of quality interventions for our children and young people at a cost that they can all get involved, and we can train our workforce to do that. One thing we did just to finish off is we have a partnership with SAMH, and that was something we formed before the pandemic, but that's been really helpful for us as we've come out the pandemic. SAMH have helped us to train the Active School Sports Development Community Sport Hub and our governing body network to understand mental health, because it's not their bag, and how we can then begin to have conversations and really help the children and young people and our volunteers deal with this and really provide quality opportunities. It's a hard one, but I think in Scotland we are big enough or small enough to be able to work together to do that.
Thank you, Jacqueline. And it's really interesting listening to you, that things are a bit, the net zero agenda and the free travel for young people and all those things that sit in another portfolio outside health would have an impact on health as well. It's interesting listening to you pull that together. Can I come to Dr. Booth and then to Kevin Kane before we move on to questions from Emma Harper? Dr. Booth.
Great, thank you. And I just wanted to echo Jacqueline's sentiments there about bringing together all of these different approaches, because to improve the physical activity levels and the health and well-being of our young people, it's not just about participation in sport. It's about physical activity in a holistic way. So active commuting is key, but also being physically active throughout the day. So we know that there's good things taking part in schools. And one of the big things that are coming out from research is thinking about physically active lessons. So this old idea that children need to sit down to learn is really being challenged. And we know from the evidence that children can learn just as well when they're doing things physically, and that actually sometimes they learn in a better way when they're up out of their seats learning things, you know. And this is often down to the innovations of teachers, where they're getting pupils outside and they're moving around, or they're using sports halls to engage movement and pairing it with the learning outcomes. So we need to move away from thinking about physical activity as being separate from academic attainment, and seeing the two can be combined, and they will support physical health as well as our school attainment, rather than seeing the two as completely separate. So again, I would like to echo that it's about thinking about the whole day and not just compartmentalising school, and thinking about building activity into the whole of the young person's day, and how we can do that and how we can support all aspects of their learning.
Can I come to Kevin Kane?
I would agree. That was some wonderfully made points. It's important not to lose sight of physical well-being and sport. This also ties to the role of outdoor learning, which was so crucial during periods of lockdown. There's been recognition from OECD and now Scottish Government that outdoor experiences should be accessible to young people. And this is where I think a little bit of vision is required in terms of the initial question about facilities. The association between physical well-being and emotional well-being and all the transferable skills are well known. And for our part, youth workers ensure activities are inclusive and fun, and that contributes to the overall confidence and well-being of those involved. I can speak anecdotally to the local YMCA facility, religiously manned by a chap called Archie near my home, in Cumbernauld Athletics Clubs as well. I wouldn't have continued in competitive athletics done my coaching awards, my skills in dealing with people, groups, working in teams would have been diminished if not for that time and space being available to me in the Heart community, particularly at a time between ages 15 and 17 when I was taking part in activities that were bad for my health. So it had a diversionary element to it as well, ignited my enthusiasm in sport and just kept me going. So everybody needs an Archie in their life, and everybody needs that right to access what was, thinking back on it, a youth work opportunity, but it was the facility that made it possible on my doorstep. Right now, there's actually an SNP commitment sitting in the manifesto for the last elections about strengthening the statutory basis of community learning and development. So that is sitting there, and there's an opportunity if we push on an open door, get the right people round the table, and we get the direction of the travel of the discussion on a right to providing that opportunity, then that would give young people and youth workers and those who are behind the notion of people having this wonderful potential on their doorstep a reality. But right now, they can't access a right to something because it can easily be shut down, it can easily be budgeted against, it can be deprioritised. But if you have a right to something, it changes the game entirely, as we've seen with the incorporation of UNCRC and the culture shift in how you approach a wellbeing economy. So I would ask the committee to be thinking about, if it's your own colleagues or if it's cross-party basis, having this discussion about that education authority's duty to provide youth work and what that actually means. We could strengthen that. And that would mean bringing a lot of people around the table, including CLD Standards, Council and others. So I hope that loops back round to the initial question. If you make that the drive, if you start from your vision and what you're about, what do we need to do, then you start to talk about how far away does a facility need to be, what are the opening hours, who benefits, is there a rural dimension to this, and so on and so on.
Thank you for that. And can I come quickly to Mike Corbett before I go to Emma Harper. Mike.
Yeah, just briefly, convener. It was just in terms of the talk of getting pupils up and about in lessons inside the classroom, and that's part of physical activity. And it was just to say, I mean, I was teaching up until the October break before I moved into this post. So I've taught through much of the pandemic, and particularly in the secondary sector, with the mitigations and kids not being able to work in groups and in rigid rows, etc., which is all absolutely necessary, it was really difficult to build on some excellent work that had been done in previous years on getting kids up and about in lessons. And absolutely, there have been efforts in schools to try and do more outdoor learning, but look out the window, and that's not particularly appealing some days in the winter in Scotland. So it was just really that to point out that's another challenge that we've had, that a lot of kids have missed out over the past 18 months in that kind of lesson, but hopefully something that we can address.
Thank you, Mike. Can I come to Emma Harper? Emma.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everybody. It's been quite interesting hearing everybody's thoughts so far. I'm interested in a couple of questions about collaboration and multi-agency working, and some of you have mentioned that already. I think Kevin Keane mentioned the Scouts Scotland, and Jacqueline Lynn described Sport Scotland and that role. And I know we've got an aim to have multi-agency working. So I'm wondering if the panel can provide examples of where there's been good collaboration with schools to support health and wellbeing, and maybe what some of the barriers to greater collaboration would be, please. I think, I guess, because Kevin Keane has been mentioning lots of youth workers and Scout Scotland and also rural, maybe we'll come to Kevin Keane first, convener, if that's okay.
And a reminder for anyone else who wants to come in on that to use the chat box. Kevin.
Yeah, that's a great. I'm so glad you asked it. We've got so many great youth work examples. The trouble preparing for today is actually going through them all, and which also says to me that there's a lot of quantitative evidence out there that we would be happy to provide. One of the examples we have is from Perth and Kinross and Gannachy Trust Universal Youth Work Partnership, where funds were targeted to those in greatest need. It involved YMCA, Eastern Perthshire Youth Alliance, Logos, Highland Perthshire, Breathe, Aberfeldy and Kythe Youth Work. It was their commitment to collaboration that saw them deliver a really dynamic programme. They managed to reach out to new members and locations against a backdrop of COVID-19 restrictions. They were proactively building local authority and third sector partnerships under the umbrella of meeting communities where they are. The difference that made was that it provided youth work to areas at a time when other services were being curtailed. And it's been really refreshing to see that East Lothian Council's new strategy is aiming to capture the best of the multi-agency crisis responding and model that up. They're also taking the approach that mental health and wellbeing is everyone's business. That's actually the name of their strategy as well, by the way. You can look it up. It's everyone's business. It's really aptly named. And it's relevant to the overarching question about schools, because they now have a mental health youth worker in each secondary school cluster. So that's full-time youth workers, six of them, and they're linking that to the East Lothian Mental Health and Wellbeing Triage Group, including NHS, MyPass, voluntary and CLD workers. And cleverly, they've synced it with their COVID Youth Work Recovery Fund and referrals on wider youth work offers as well. So that means we can bring in sports, arts, outdoor education and awards. And awards beyond just sitting an exam and getting that kind of recognition, we know is absolutely crucial. And the Awards Network in Scotland do a fantastic job of putting together that programme. The process, crucially for us, is aided by youth workers. They've acknowledged that during the pandemic, this approach does help young people maintain healthy relationships. And if I may, just very quickly, in terms of partnerships, because this is relevant as well, and it's example-based and crucial to further in the agenda, that the time and space we talked about for young people, we need that time and space for youth workers as well. It's been hinted at by other witnesses. A great example we have from the Outdoor Education Recovery Fund is the Branching Upwards project in the Scottish Borders. They created a forest school with 77 local primary schools at a crucial age where play and youth work intersects. They collaborated and learned in and around nature. Pupils got their Outdoor Achievement Award. 76% of participants said they'd improved confidence, and significantly, all had improved their physical and health and wellbeing. And then this was reinforced by the teaching staff. And that also happened in the New Tracks project, a partnership between Youth Community Support Agency in Govan Hill, involving three local secondary schools, voluntary sector groups in Glasgow Life. They worked with 120 young people between 10 and 19 and through outdoor projects, a focus on art and sport. 83% of those young folk reported being more engaged in learning. So not only were they getting the breadth of learning experience, it actually was in a formal setting was impacting on them as well. Their self-esteem was improved, and more than half of them went on to achieve their John Muir Award. So basically, what are we saying here is that partnerships, collaboration, intervention, prevention is built in to the youth work approach, and it will be intensely needed as we move forward and we continue this discussion on Scotland recovery and renewal.
Thank you. Can I come to Judy Edwards?
Thank you. Before I give some examples, I'd just like to echo the theme of this discussion that absolutely schools and nurseries can't do this alone, and the whole system approach which is being discussed and the value of further strengthening partnerships is absolutely the way forward. In terms of some examples, we've obviously heard from Jacqueline Lynn this morning, and I'd just like to reinforce the benefit of the Active Schools programme that has, I mentioned earlier, our work on focusing on the inactive to the active, and our Active Schools colleagues have supported us in that work in identifying data to give us evidence of where we need to focus our efforts. Also, our work with Active Schools has shifted to much more of an equitable provision. So we have focused greatly on our young people in areas of deprivation. We've also had a focus on inclusion And for example, we've shifted our priorities around the Duke of Edinburgh Awards scheme to trying to get those young people in those areas of deprivation or those that are need to be more included, having that support. Another thing I'd like to mention as an example is the Get Into Summer funding, which we had last summer, and I know there are some national meetings about that coming up over the next few weeks. We had over 30 third sector organisations within Stirling supporting that, again, focusing on, for example, the supporting those children in the transition from primary into secondary during the pandemic, and also those affected, those children who are identified by our schools and nurseries perhaps as having some mental health challenges. So that's been another example supported by some additional funding to allow us to further engage with our third sector community, which is an invaluable resource in this area of work. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come to Mike Corbett?
Thanks, Convener. A couple of organisations that I wanted to focus on are Active Life, who've done some award-winning work with young Black children, and Intercultural Youth Scotland as well, who've also done some great work too, working with minorities. And with them, and I think many others, the key issue is resources. And I think for many organisations, resources perhaps to take them beyond the central belt, because it is a fact that there's a huge number of organisations doing great work, but many of them are maybe doing that in the central belt and not beyond, and maybe not as able to move into rural areas to do that. So I think that would be an important thing to look at. And while we're talking about, and we absolutely would support the idea of multi-agency work, you know, as I said before, schools can't do all of this on their own. But we shouldn't forget the college sector as well, which is vitally important. And again, we've had evidence of, just from local authority to local authority, different approaches being taken. You know, some fantastic work where, in some places, where colleges work with the local authority and school timetables across the local authority in order to make it easier for pupils to get out to college on particular afternoons. But then other authorities where, you know, it's the individual head teacher's timetable and you don't get that level of collaboration. So, you know, that's just something else that I think is important and, again, can be improved and expanded upon.
Thank you very much. Can I move to Jacqueline Lynn wants to come in this, Emma, and I'll come back to you, Emma.
OK.
Thank you. I guess it's just that very supportive of the multi-agency work. Probably two things from us, and one's more a higher level of strategic forum that we set up, which brings together local authorities, leisure trusts, the higher and further education, Public Health Scotland, Scottish Government, our governing bodies, really to say how do we help recover and where do children and young people fit in that. We've got four themes that have come out of that. But one of the things you were saying was, you know, we all believe in multi-agency work, but one of the challenges is then we all come together, but what do we do together? And I think that's something we need to get. We need to have action out of some of these. So that forum's got 12 recommendations and we're beginning to get action. So I think if we can do that, that will help us work better. The other one that I would like to raise is similar to Judy. I think Get Into Summer has shown where a bit of additional resource shows really good collaboration locally with a whole range of partners that we didn't, you know, you wouldn't work with before, and our local authority and third sector partners. There's great examples, and I know they've evaluations just coming out from Scottish Government on that. So it's just to highlight that as well. And like everyone, you know, the more we can work together and drive, the better. So thanks for that.
Thank you. Emma, have you got any a follow-up question? And then I'll come to Evelyn Tweed after you.
Yep, just a quick follow-up. It's about you know, the collaborating work and third sector and all these different roles that we have. And I think it's really important that Mike Corbett mentioned minority groups, because we don't want to leave anybody behind. But I'm just, is there more that can be done to improve how everybody understands what everybody's role is? Because, yes, we get everybody around the table, but how can we make sure that everybody understands what everybody's role is?
Emma, have you directed that to anyone in particular?
I haven't, but I think maybe Dr. Josie Booth.
Thanks. I was thinking MK might have more good examples here than I do of how to establish people's role. And I think everybody's combined and we're talking about whole systems approaches and working together being particularly beneficial, and maybe seeing that roles are not separate and that actually we've all got this combined interest. So I don't know if I've got a good example where somebody would be leading that essentially. My experience from the research evidence, from, as I said, the James Lind Alliance report and from the Triumph report, when they brought together young people, their families and teachers and those involved in health as well, shows that actually listening to the young people and letting them drive it and them determine, you know, where they need the support and what is most beneficial is probably key for overcoming some of the challenges that we're facing at the moment.
Thank you. Emma, can I move on to questions from Evelyn Tweed? Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. And for the record, I am currently a councillor at Stirling Council. And good morning, panel. Well, my question is, what can be done to promote greater co-production of services that actively involves young people and their families? And it's great to see Judy Edwards here today, and I would like to pose this question to Judy. Thank you.
Thank you.
What can be done to greater reduce co-production? I think that was your question, Councillor Tweed. Well, one of the things that we strongly believe in as a local authority, I'm sure others are the same, is that we have to listen to our young people. We have to involve them in policy making, in decision making. And I mentioned the health and wellbeing census earlier. And actually, I think that's one way that we can do that. We had what we call a gathering of our young people a few years ago to really listen to them. We did it in collaboration with our health colleagues to really listen to young people about what is it that they need, what is it they want, what would help, how can we involve them more. And I think obviously we have to be having discussions with our partners about the practicalities of that, but we need to hear from our young people what is it that we're getting right, what is it we're not getting right, and how, what do they think we can do to help this. So going forward then, it is about taking that information, whether it be from an event such as a gathering or from data gathered from a census or from however else we get it. I think we have to take that information then, and we have to take it with us as leaders, as citizens. We have to take that into our work and find ways that we can then co-produce with our young people. They are the future, and they are the ones that will tell us what they need and what they want. So it's our job then to take that information, as I've said, into everything that we do and find ways, and there are ways, and find ways to include them and co-produce with them.
Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. And my second question is around COVID and what lessons that we can actually learn from the experiences of collaboration during the pandemic, and what is being done to embed these lessons for the future. And I'd like to ask Jacqueline Lynn, please.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I think we've learned lots of lessons already in the kind of 2 years we're there. I think what we've learned is, you know, it's going back to what Councillor said earlier, it's about understanding each other and understanding the different roles we play, but more importantly, understanding the needs of the children and young people and the families, particularly then the vulnerable families. And I think throughout the pandemic, that this has given us all an opportunity to refocus and to look at that. I think we can't underestimate the challenge of that. And I think we go back to learning. You know, there's a whole workforce out there in sport and we hear youth work, but we don't all have the same skills. So how do we upskill our workforce to be able to meet the needs of these people and work together and learn? So you hear Judy, we have great relationships with Stirling Council. So how do we make sure that the teachers are working with active schools, with the sports development, with the third sector, with the clubs in the areas and the volunteers that are putting on sport and physical activity? So I think we've learned those lessons. I think what we need to do though is make sure we then
take them forward and come out the other end and recover in a positive way? And how has this been done to embed? I see already, I mentioned earlier about the work in Renfrewshire and Aberdeen, where we know that active schools teams have been given quite significant budgets and in Fife to really start to demonstrate where they can actually provide sport and physical activity for the more vulnerable families. So already I think we see things happening. I don't want to paint it all rosy because we know we've got a long way to go, but I think these are great examples of where, you know, we can really make a difference for the well-being of our children and young people, and sport and physical activity can play a contribution towards that.
Thanks. I'll bring in Mike Corbett and then Dr. Booth, and then we'll need to move on to questions from Gillian Mackay. Can I bring in Mike, please?
Yeah, we've talked a fair bit about financial resources, which obviously are vital, but I think in terms of embedding anything, and in this case collaborative work, it's time is the key resource. The OECD review pointed out that Scotland's teachers have more class contact time and larger class sizes than almost any of our competitor nations. And I appreciate there's been a commitment to reduce pupil contact time for teachers, but that commitment is by the end of the parliament, so we would be pressing for that to be done sooner rather than later. But also I think a reduction in class sizes is needed to create that space for teachers to be meeting with, collaborating with all of these other, you know, great organisations that we've been talking about. But if that time's not there and you've got, you know, stressed out teachers with excessive workload, then a lot of the good work that's been done could be lost unless, you know, we get that commitment.
Thank you. Can I come to Dr. Booth?
Yeah, thank you. I was just going to say, very similar to Mike there, that one of the issues with actually engaging is that teachers don't have the time necessarily, and they're under increasing pressure. And I think when there's a rhetoric of them having to improve academic performance, that actually their ability to really focus on health and well-being can sometimes be given a sort of back seat, if you like. Whereas actually, as I said earlier, that we need to prioritise health and well-being, because children can't learn effectively if they're not healthy and well. And teachers need the time to be able to do this. They need the resource to be able to do this. And part of that resource is about them having adequate training and support in service. So the school council is a great thing, but also them actually having opportunities and training from experts in how to engage children in physical activity, you know, and not just in a telling children these are the things you should be doing, but about them having a holistic view of what a healthy life is, and about positive health promotion rather than just a reactive sense of dealing with issues. So how do we all support a positive healthy life? And part of that is about role modelling. And so I completely agree with Mike that teachers need to have pressure taken off them for prioritising things. They also need to have time to undertake training, time to engage in these multi-partner discussions, and how do they actually embed that? So I completely agree that we need to support teachers to be able to do that.
Right, we're going to move on to community and family approaches. Gillian Mackay, you've got questions here.
Thank you, Convener. Has the pandemic undermined attempts to take a whole family approach? Are schools finding it more difficult to engage with parents after remote learning? And could I come to Mike Corbett first on this?
Yeah, well, we don't have comprehensive evidence of that, but certainly anecdotally that is definitely, you know, an issue, I think. And I mean, I could give you examples of my own time when I was still teaching, and you know, we tried to do as many live lessons as we could, but quite often I would be sitting there not just with the black screens of cameras off from the pupils who were there, which was slightly perturbing, but we got around it. But quite often with, you know, 10, 12 of my class of 30 not actually turning up for that live lesson, and all sorts of reasons behind that, which, you know, schools did try and address and try to make contact and made contact with some families, you know, and we were able to address that. But in other cases, just getting nothing back. And a sense that many were just, you know, going into a protective cocoon almost. So I think you're right, there does need to be some work to re-establish some of those relationships. But quite, you know, how extended that problem is, I'm not sure, but certainly have some anecdotal evidence that it is there and needs it.
Can we come to Judy Edwards?
During the pandemic, I would say that our schools and nurseries found amazing and innovative ways to engage with families and facilitate and offer online learning. But in terms of support and relationships and working with families, it wasn't the same online. And I think for some families, it maybe was okay, but for many families that they tell us, and our schools and nursery staff tell us, that they felt they weren't having quite the same engagement, the depth of engagement, when it wasn't face to face. So without a doubt, I think there's been a detrimental impact on that area of our work. Prior to that question being asked, I actually wanted to come in and say, I think it just coincided with the conversation moving on to that question, but I actually wanted to come in to say that in the round of what we're considering at this meeting today, I think we have to absolutely keep our eye on family learning, because while we talked about health and wellbeing being a curricular responsibility of all, obviously, the health and wellbeing of our young people is the responsibility of all the partners we've talked about earlier, our schools and nurseries, and also our families. And if we're thinking about something, even just nutrition, for example, we have recently used some funding we had from a partner agency to provide soup recipes and ingredients to make soup. It sounds simple, but for some of our families, that's been eye-opening, and what they're telling us, it's the first time they've made homemade soup. So I think we have to keep our focus on how we are educating our families to improve the health and wellbeing of our children and young people.
Thank you for that. Can I come to Kevin Kane for a come back to Gillian?
Thank you. I mentioned a wee bit about families and food insecurity and stigma and in earlier answers, say too much. However, it was interesting that one of our members working in children's homes, that they reported some of the young people engaging better. I say some engaging better during lockdown because of the less formal approach to learning. For many of the practitioners, they could see that there was an impact then on the wider family, and it's led to discussions around the need for greater recognition of the need to engage and continue that approach. And the question of how we do that ties to the previous two questions on rights and recovery. There's been a lot of debate on a wellbeing economy in recent times, and we hope that doesn't go away. And we believe that a wellbeing economy can work, but we need to listen to what youth workers are telling us, and that's that partnerships, prevention, early intervention, whole community and family responding, all that stuff that was to the fore during the crisis, that if we embolden that successful partnership approach and get people around the table, we could develop a multi-sector, multi-agency workforce which is dedicated to people's health and well-being, and that might ameliorate some of the challenges that have been highlighted around getting together but not doing the action, or going off and working in our own lane, because we would have that dedicated scaffold and the core which directs every one of us around that national vision for a well-being economy, and within that dedicated multi-sectoral workforce. And as we've seen, there's so much good work that we can repeat or upscale, but it'll take time and patience as well, and that includes from politicians, because it can be very easy to react and continually react and fund and then not fund, and then you get caught in that cycle, and that's competitive. But if we agree to a core vision, I think it strips away some of that competitiveness that's in the landscape.
Gillian, do you have a supplementary question you want to direct to anyone?
Yes, please. So obviously in the current context, different schools are working in different ways depending on their their situation with COVID and things like that. So in that context, how difficult is it currently making to take a whole family approach when there's maybe one child in secondary school and one child in primary school, or different children at different stages of their education? And could I come to Judy Edwards first?
I don't know that taking a whole family approach is particularly an issue if the children are in different schools, because if we're talking about educating the parents, if you like, along with the child, or educating the parents in whichever way we do that, I personally don't see that as being too much of an issue. There are things, for example, programmes such as the ESOL programme, which is for English learners from other languages, I can't remember exactly what it stands for, where that would be a whole family approach. It would happen out with the school day, and you'd have the children and the parents together learning. So as long as there are types of activities like that where it's appropriate and relevant, the whole family can come together, I don't see it as a huge issue that the children may be in different schools, personally.
Gillian, can I move on to Paul O'Kane's questions? Thank you, Paul.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I suppose following on from that theme and that line of questioning, I just want to talk about the community approach. And I think we've already started to hear a flavour of the benefit, really, associated with taking a community-based approach. But I wonder if Kevin might want to expand on some of the benefits of really the role of communities in enhancing wellbeing of young people.
Kevin.
Thank you very much. The question, it broke up a wee bit there, my apologies. Was that the role of communities?
Yeah, we're speaking quite powerfully just in the question before, Kevin, about I think that kind of community-based approach essentially. Just keen to get a sense from you of what more essentially we can do in communities as well.
Yeah, I think it's worth to listen to our communities first and foremost. And at the heart of this discussion today, it's about what's best for young people. I'm aware that young people have more access, at least there's an intention that they access power in a way that they maybe didn't before. It's a challenge to do that. I mean, even if you look across the committee today, we all represent organisations, and that's part of our role. And you need catalyst organisations and people to bring together information and to advocate for a sector. But what I would say is, if we could bring that advocacy, we could bring that voice to people more often in their local communities. And given the fact that youth work is positioned within the local authority and the voluntary sector, and we're connected to thousands of young people right now, the right approach would be to invest in that infrastructure, but it would also be financially astute. We know from countless research, including from Unison, that there's a social return for investing in youth work. And that's not just money, that's people, that's facilities, that's careers, it's the time and space that we've spoken about. And if we can do that, we can bring more young people to every level of decision making, which would be fantastic. And that would also be in keeping with Scotland's ambition on UNCRC, which was received cross-party support, as you know, one of the best things I think I've ever seen happen in the Scottish Parliament. We'll be going through a period of implementation, and youth workers are keenly positioned within communities to drive some of that ambition forward. We had young people and youth workers from North Lanarkshire, Ayrshire, Shetland, just to name a few, talking directly to the Equality Committee on their priorities and hopes for incorporation. But they also do that at a community level as well, because our sector's rights respecting, rights promoting, and we're unashamed about it. There's youth councils built into local authority structures, and the cultural shift from UNCRC is such that more people are looking at diverse, innovative ways to bring communities together. And when I say communities, that's young people, that's whole families. The intergenerational potential of the sector to tackle social isolation, to bring communities together around a cause, as we saw in Maryhill the other day, of people power to the fore, and they kept a library open. That's phenomenal. So we believe for that to happen, that it's the youth workers that can enable the young folk to realise their Article 12 right to be part of the decisions that affect them and ultimately be the change that they wish to see.
Thank you, Kevin. And I'm smiling along because I was in the committee, of course, that scrutinised the UNCRC. And I remember your evidence then and the amount of work we did with young people and how strongly they felt about it. So thank you. Can I come quickly to Jacqueline Lynn before Paul, if you've got a supplementary, then I'll come back to you. Jacqueline.
Yeah, I think it's just the importance, Paul, of that pathway in sport and physical activity, and that community-based approach is where the sport happens in our clubs and in our community sport hubs. And we've worked since 2014, the legacy of the Commonwealth Games, across the 32 local authorities, and we've got over 200 community sport hubs, which did start off very much as sport, but as they've evolved over that duration, they've become very much community-based organisations. And if we just take Drumchapel, which started off as gymnastics and table tennis, a pathway of turning young people onto the club and the performance stage, that's now a whole community-based approach, which has got, you know, classes and programmes for older people, for people with mental health issues, and it becomes a social space for that committee. So it's the community-based approach is really important as we move out of COVID and making sure that particularly the children and young people out with school, where do they go, how do we use the facilities which are in our communities to really provide those opportunities, and more importantly is how do we get the young people and understand what they would like in these facilities in the community. So the community-based approach from a sport and physical activity is really critical to where we are and how we drive this forward.
Thanks, Paul. Have you got a supplementary question to anyone?
Yeah, I think maybe just a supplementary to Mike, just on the role that a school plays within the kind of community approach, because I think schools are, in my part, certainly always really keen to enhance that strong community approach. I think are having to do less, more with less, and work with community organisations that are also experiencing the same. But I wonder if Mike had any reflections on the role of the school in terms of the community approach.
Yeah, I mean, you touch on something there, Paul, that was working really well in many areas before the pandemic. You know, the whole notion of community schools, and as has been touched on, the idea of opening up the facilities in schools to the whole community being important. And obviously, that's something that has been missing for a while, but I think it's probably easier to get back to. But the only other thing I think I would just touch on briefly, because I know we're short for time, is that notion of how you get the not just the pupil voice, but the family voice involved. And I think we have to be careful that when we do questionnaires, surveys, etc., you know, as schools and other organisations, that we're not just getting, if you like, the usual suspects responding. That I think, you know, we need to do a bit more work to reach out. And schools have always done this, to reach out to those who maybe are not turning up to the parents meeting or are not signing off the school report, etc. And I think that point, you know, stands more broadly in terms of, you know, reaching out to a number of families in the community and genuinely finding out what they want and what we can do to help.
Thank you. I'll move on to our final theme on deprivation barriers to wellbeing, and the questions from David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to panel members. We've heard about partnership working and evidence this morning from the panel members, and we've heard highlights of several examples. Around areas of deprivation and the barriers it creates to children and young people's health and wellbeing, what role should public services play in bringing together key partners and creating strong networks in deprived communities, and how can this be achieved? And I'll go to Kevin Kane first, just because of his positive comments about Kirkcaldy High School in Scotland.
I thought you might, Kevin.
Well, now I'm feeling a wee bit of the pressure to be positive, which we will be, because we're campaigning around a vision here. I think I can hear from the committee members that were keen to drive this agenda forward. A short answer, it's huge. It's absolutely huge. The local authority elections are coming up. We will have a youth work manifesto with aims very clearly stated in there. And so I would put it back to parliamentarians to say, unite the national message with the local authority vision and invest accordingly in public services, and make the statement that they're sacrosanct. They're not going away. Embed it into law. Even it's absolutely crucial that every step of government and that's written in to strategies and plans. Our vision is that young people are supported through key relationships with youth workers to achieve their potential. There's a youth work strategy coming up, and during the Fairer Scotland assessment, which is one of the equality assessments that sits alongside it, we've been doing a lot of work on youth work's approach in this space. It's crucial that any Scottish government or local authority plan, regardless of political hue, recognises youth work's integral role in delivering for young people and communities, and delivering being the launchpad, the linchpin around any local anti-poverty strategies. So I went short answer to long answer. You can, but emphatic, absolutely yes, David. And it needs to be clear, and there's a PR exercise in there as well. So that's communicated with the public, and that ripple effect is taken out there for people who also believe in public services to repeat that message among their people.
Thank you, Rart. Carol Mockin has got some questions around poverty. David, did you have anything else you wanted to ask?
Yes, thank you.
Carol.
Hi, thank you. I found the information really, really useful. I am particularly interested in young people from poorer backgrounds and how we can encourage them to take part in all sorts of activities, sport, use of green spaces. So some of what was said before was music to my ears around local services and local government funding. I just wonder, what are the barriers in particular for young people both at the schools and out with the schools in access and sport and activity, and what is it that we as parliamentarians need to do to try and break down those barriers and give people that opportunity to take part, particularly as I say, from people from poorer backgrounds?
And maybe go to Jacqueline Lynn on that first of all, Carol.
Thanks, yeah, that'd be great.
Thanks very much, Carol. Yeah, Sport Scotland, and with our commitment to the 32 local authorities, we are fully committed to really driving inclusion and reducing the inequalities in sport and for physical activity, particularly for children and young people from poorer backgrounds. I think the barriers are probably quite well documented where we are, and it's what are we going to do. Those barriers are sometimes just confidence to be able to go along and take part and be part of it, and also to have the skills and abilities to take part. Fundamentally, I think the other thing is really there is that the opportunity of money. You know, there isn't the money, so the poverty and low income are huge across all the local authorities at the moment, and we can really see the difference. And we've actually got evidence from some of our research that in active schools, the opportunities from decile 1 to 10 are fairly equal. Some dips, but when you actually go into that community, into the clubs and into the community organisations, there's a real difference, and that is because of confidence, skills and funding. I think the other thing we have to remember about young people is they also have choices, and they want to make that choice, and we need to again listen to them and go back to the choice. Just at the moment, the last thing for me is we have targeted 10 local authorities who have got really, you know, projects around where we're driving inclusion, and one of the ones that is really interesting is down in North Ayrshire with the active schools teams down there, and their whole systems approach is put a dedicated person in to drive inclusion in active schools, and they are working with probably about 6 families just now, and the Get Into Summer money really helped them to provide opportunities that the families had never had, going to swimming together, you know, taking part in, you know, bowling, 10-pin bowling, you know. So I think there's opportunities, and that would be where we are. They would be the barriers that we see, Carol. And again, that multi-agency approach to driving and working together to take away some of those barriers would help.
Thank you.
And can I come to Mike Corbett?
Thanks, convener. I mean, we've done some research in the past about the problems with the cost of the school day generally, and things like, you know, school uniform, equipment, money for school trips, etc. And I think the same applies here if you're looking at sports. You know, so sometimes money for sports kit, money for sports equipment, money to travel to, you know, where the sporting activity is taking place, you know, equally is an issue, I think, for many. So, you know, that campaign that we've had in the past about poverty proofing the school day, I think could be applied more widely to sports activities and other areas.
Thank you. And Carol, was there anything else you want to follow up on?
No, I think that just confirms some of the stuff, as you say, the work that we need to do. So that's really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. And our final committee member asking questions, we have Sue Weber. Sue.
Good morning, panel, and thanks for coming on. It's a really informative session, and I suppose I should declare an interest as a councillor in Edinburgh, but also as a mad keen hockey fan and umpire, and I've seen firsthand the role that sports clubs and their teams of volunteers can play in addressing those inequalities. And I don't know, I get a sense that it's down to the hard work of the clubs, more so than policy, that's assisting with the tackling the inequalities. So I'm just really trying to figure out in my head, do you get a sense that the Scottish Government's focus on supporting equity in schools is dovetailing with other policies which are supporting the health and well-being in deprived communities and families?
And who would you like to direct that to first?
Jacqueline Lynn first, I think. Convener, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. I think, Sue, you make a great point. You know, clubs have been there for many years. They're run and driven by volunteers, committed and dedicated people that give up their time. And I think you're right. They are the ones that do all the hard work to really get people involved. I think government are trying and working hard to tackle that. I think there's a recognition that needs more to be done. But if you take the programme for government recently about the opportunity to raise the budget or double the budget to £100 million for sport and physical, you know, active living, I think there's an opportunity here. But again, it's how do we work with the clubs, the governing bodies, with the volunteers, make sure that they're supported through this journey. So undoubtedly, yep, you know, there's policy there. We need to keep driving those policies. And for us, it's going back to the Active Scotland Outcomes Framework, which we've got great policies, but how do we drive the practice and turn that into action so that the children and young people have got their opportunities? And we've got excellent examples of where clubs have done fantastic inclusion work in Edinburgh, across the country, and the work of our governing bodies. So I think there's opportunities there, but it does need resource, and we do need to really look at how we tackle for the young people that live in poverty and low incomes. I think that's really hard in terms of all of that.
Thanks.
Thank you. Can I come to Dr. Booth?
Yeah, thank you. I just wanted to bring this back a little bit to some of the evidence that came from COVID. And one of the positive things that was reported was many families saying that actually, due to the restrictions and the permissible one outing a day, that many families were saying they actually spent more time going out for a walk, for example, as a family, than they had done previously. And that actually, when they, some families especially, weren't taking children to lots of different clubs, that actually they had a little bit more time to go for a walk together or to access the wonderful outdoor resources that we have in Scotland. And I think that that's one of the key things that is not being discussed as much. And obviously we touched on outdoor education, and potentially that's quite an important role here, that it's not just about the use of clubs, although I'm not saying they don't play a huge part, especially for areas of high deprivation, but actually encouraging a love and a view of the outdoors as being something that everybody can, if we support them, everybody can access, and that actually that has a huge role to play, especially for young people from more deprived areas where they're not able to go to different sporting clubs as easily, if you like, as young people from more affluent areas. So potentially embracing that outdoor education as being really key here is quite important.
Thank you. Sue, have you got any more questions you'd like to put to our panellists?
No, I'm fine. Thanks, Convener.
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, I want to thank our panellists for the time they've spent with us this morning. Your evidence is hugely valuable and very much echoing quite a lot of what we've already heard from other panels that we're doing in this inquiry. I'm going to suspend this meeting until 10:55 to allow our next panel to onboard. Thank you. Welcome back to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Our third item today is an evidence session on the National Planning Framework 4. And a welcome to the committee, Eileen Buteman, Place and Wellbeing Partnership Lead for Improvement Service, Dr. Matt Lowther, Head of Communities and Local Partners for Public Health Scotland, and Professor Jamie Pearce, Professor of Health Geography, School of Geosciences from the University of Edinburgh. Welcome to you all. So with regard to MPF4, livable places is one of the things on the strategy that I think we're quite interested in terms of how they're going to be designed for health and well-being. First of all, I'd like to ask the panel, what do we know about those spaces and those livable places? Do we have enough information as to what those will look like and what sort of things we should be striving for? And is there particular aspects of this framework that will have a particular impact on our nation's health and well-being? And I'll just go around everyone, if you don't mind, if I could maybe just go first of all to Eileen.
Yeah, thanks very much, and thanks for the opportunity to speak today. Livable places is up there, high up in the strategy, which is to be welcomed. The link into public health and into keeping us healthy is almost joining together the two ambitions of planning, which is about, you know, managing the land and use of buildings in the long-term public interest. And if we want to look at what that public interest is, it sits there within public health. I feel that's what gives us the evidence and the research that tells us what we need to be doing in places and what every place needs for it to be more livable, for it to enable us to use places in a more preventative manner to keep people well and to also have them thriving and to be dealing with other inequalities that Scotland's facing at the moment. So in my role, I've been doing a lot of work on linking together what the Improvement Service does to help councils and particular planning authorities to deliver those kinds of places, to link in with all of the evidence that sits within public health to see what are the things we need to get right. And we've spent a number of years now pulling together a set of place and wellbeing outcomes that we've submitted into the parliamentary ask for views a couple of weeks ago at the beginning of January, that sets out what every place needs in order for everyone in those places to thrive. And they move around different themes, and they give a lot more clarity perhaps than I can see within the text in the National Planning Framework at the moment, around how we move around, our access to space, open space, streets and spaces, our access to facilities, amenities, affordable homes, to work, and our ability to take part in society, to feel safe, to have a sense of belonging. All of those aspects come into the behaviour change from somebody stepping out their front door that will mean they have that opportunity to lead a more active life that will help their physical, mental well-being, but also that changes the decisions that they can make that impact on whether they're living in poverty or not, and whether they feel socially isolated or not, or feel supported when they perhaps hit trauma or any kind of issue in their life, whether they feel supported by their community around them as well. An important aspect as we look at our ageing population as well. So, there are evidence links there. We have submitted them in around the place and wellbeing outcomes. And an overall set of comments that I've been hearing is a lack of clarity at the moment in the National Planning Framework to help us hit the ground running. This is a document that's going to be used by development management for big decisions being made as soon as it's taken on board. We could really hit the ground running and help to deliver places that are delivering on all of our crises at the moment around climate, around inequalities, health inequalities, COVID recovery, and so on. So I think there's a bit more clarity we could be getting right, and being clear that we need all of them, not a debate across 32 councils of, well, we're using 10 or we're only using 4. I think all sectors need that clarity and confidence.
Yeah, Ivan, you just hit upon the fact that, you know, that obviously it's at council level, and local development plans, really. I mean, and obviously a lot, we're about to have council elections, and there may be new new councillors coming into that role, people who have not been councillors before, do you think there's a need for them to have a degree of training as to what MPF4's goals are and how what they do and the decisions that they make need to be dovetail into that?
Absolutely, yes, there definitely is a need for training because, as we can see, the National Planning Framework has a new set of outcomes that have not been there before for planning to be delivering upon. We have outcomes now around health and wellbeing, and not just delivering on housing and delivering on growth, but delivering for our ageing population, for biodiversity and for climate, but to do it together, not to be off in silos delivering on one aspect of a climate crisis and how a place contributes, a healthy town versus a climate-based town. It has to be combining that up. And the skills to be able to understand that link up and to be adding that level of scrutiny when officers and councils are moving things forward. I think it's kind of highlighted even this week where I've seen a lot about one of our councils approving an out-of-town retail centre at a time where really we need to be moving and thinking about car-orientated development, how we move that hierarchy. So, having that buy-in and having that understanding so that they can also be truly representing all of our society as well and their needs. And understanding that link to decisions made about an out-of-town housing development have an impact on those living in the town who have no access to a car. There's a link there and understanding around that.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I come to Dr. McLowther?
Yes, thank you and morning everyone. First of all, I guess Public Health Scotland, we really welcome NPF4 and really welcome the focus on health and public health. I think this is probably the first time that this document or this planning framework has really had that focus on health, and it's writ large throughout the document. So, from a public health perspective, that's really, really welcome to see because, we've recognised for quite a while just the impact that good quality places can have on health and long-term health outcomes. But actually to see that sort of formally recognised and embedded in such an important document is really welcome. You specifically asked about the living places, and of course that is where the majority of the health stuff sits, I guess. But I guess health is woven through and can be woven other elements. So sustainable places, will have an impact on health. Productive places, distinctive places, all of these things will ultimately have an impact on health. And you asked, I think, specifically about the components of a neighbourhood and a place that affect health. And there's lots of those. So when we talk about place, we've got a fairly broad definition of place in relation to health. And we'll maybe touch on the place standards. So that's got 14 different themes. All of those 14 themes are place-based and have evidence that sit behind them that show the impact on health. So to pick out a few specifically, so we know the way our neighbourhoods are designed. So obviously this is where people live and work and play, and how those neighbourhoods are designed can have quite significant impacts on health. They can improve the way people interact socially, they can improve levels of physical activity, they can reduce air quality, they can improve access to services, etc. Another key element is housing, and housing can impact on health through a whole raft of different mechanisms, and we'll maybe come on to talk about housing later in the session. I guess our food environment and I suppose our local environment that affects our lifestyle in terms of access to good quality foods, access to alcohol and other substances that potentially can harm our health. So again, place in the police policy can have a significant impact on those things. We also know lots of really good quality evidence that I'm sure Professor Pearce will come on to touch on around access to good quality natural and sustainable places. We know that's not only good for our mental health, but also really good for our physical health. So just being in contact with nature and having access to nature is really good for our mental and our physical health. And then finally, you know, another key element that is important to our health in terms of from a police perspective is transportation. You know, how we move around, how we access services, you know, how we can increase our levels of physical activity through active travel and active transport. So a whole variety of different mechanisms, but overall we really welcome the focus on health in the policy. Thank you.
Thank you, that's really helpful. And can I come to Professor Jamie Pearce?
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much. I think it's just worth us just reminding ourselves of some of the public health challenges in Scotland and connecting it to discussion. So, as the committee are well aware, we have some of the most significant challenges in terms of public health in Western Europe. And we, if we think about what those challenges are, or some of those challenges are, we'd probably identify mental health, alcohol, tobacco use, drug use, lower life expectancy, high health inequalities, both socially and spatially. And clearly there are a range of processes that, that explain that and things we can do. And the planning system, I think, is integral to that. But again, as previous speakers have just said, very much welcome a focus on the planning system and the significant opportunities that it offers us to improve the health of everyone in Scotland, and not least in terms of reducing inequalities, which is an important part of this. And certainly, as Matt was just alluding to there just a moment ago, there are many elements of the document, the MPF documentation, that are that would offer some welcome steps, could add benefit to the health of people in Scotland. And the green spaces, the access, the quality of those green spaces is a really good example of that, whereby we know green spaces are really beneficial for health throughout the full life course, right from birth through to older age. And we know that particularly those sort of formative experiences in terms of green space have lifelong impacts. Some really welcome things in there. But also, I guess, as a public health researcher interested in the connections between health and place, I would argue that this is quite a piecemeal approach to thinking about those connections, with some aspects that are represented really well and some which are largely overlooked. And so one of my take-home messages would be there is an opportunity here to think quite holistically about all the key challenges in terms of public health in Scotland. What are some of the underlying aspects of the planning system which are integral to addressing those, and how can we bring those things together to make a really large-scale impact in terms of improving the key public health challenges in Scotland?
Jamie, it would be remiss of me not to pick you up on the stuff you think that has been overlooked. Are you able to articulate that for us?
Yeah, so I think there are some interesting, some really, really useful things here in terms of looking at, I think, the food system, for example. So we know that obesity is one of the big challenges, and actually addressing the proliferation of highly saturated food within our communities, improving access to high quality food is important, and that I do think is starting to come through. On the other hand, there are other commodities we know which are really bad for our health, and I guess alcohol and tobacco are two of the remaining big health challenges in Scotland. So, for example, one in five deaths in Scotland is attributed to tobacco. But the availability of tobacco and alcohol are not represented within this document. And I'd say this is an important part of the planning system to make sure that we do make sure we support our communities to and have those healthy lifestyles that we all aspire to. So that'd be an example, I think, of where there's some really good opportunities here to make a significant.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. Can I move on to questions and the place of health in the framework, specifically dig into that. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. You've talked a little bit about what the National Planning Framework it contains as far as aspirations for supporting health and wellbeing. Do you think the framework has enough priority to give health and wellbeing the support that it needs in reaching planning decisions? I suppose that might be for not sure who would like to take that one.
You can go back to Professor Pearce first of all.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I think this is a key point, and probably you won't be surprised to hear me say, just based upon what I think some of the priorities are really important. The climate, carbon zero related policies are really important. Yes, you won't be surprised to hear me say I would like to see health up there as being a very high priority in terms of the opportunities we have for improving public health in Scotland. There's certainly elements of health, I think, sort of peppered through this document, but I really think we would benefit in Scotland from seeing health take a very high level priority and having a real strategic priority in terms of planning. And I think that's the way in which we're going to make sure that all Scots have access to a healthy environment in a way that's going to support their health and well-being and reduce inequalities. So yeah, I would like to see that health is a very clear priority, and that then to transcend through the whole document.
Okay, Emma, I've got to find out where other panellists want to come in. Just a bit of housekeeping that I neglected to mention. If other panellists want to come in and they've not been addressed by our committee members, there we go, are in the chat box. I'll come to Eileen Buteman. Eileen.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that's a really good question about its specific addressing of health and wellbeing, and what Jamie says about it is peppered throughout the document, but there is an emphasis stated even when we get to the actual policy that will sit there and planning policy for Scotland that says it's guided by principles around climate and nature. And that surprised me, because I feel it needs to also be guided by principles of what's happening in our Scotland in respect of the health inequality that Jamie was referring to, and to poverty as well as climate and nature and all of the outcomes that it's been asked to deliver upon. And I wonder if there's, while there is a policy there around health and wellbeing, it's fairly high level. It doesn't really get to the meat of it, and it gets on very quickly to talking about health and social care facilities, which is only one small part of how we're addressing health. And I feel there's almost a need for a further policy in there that's a little bit akin to what Wales have about asking us to think about the long-term impact of all our decisions on preventing those persistent problems that we have in the country. So yes, that's climate change, but that is also including other inequalities such as poverty, the role of place and the places we create can have a huge impact on that, and then likewise also health inequality as well. So it's perhaps an overarching policy that's missing there, and certainly simply having guiding principles that are around climate and nature are laudable, but that again public health is missing from that.
And I'll come to Dr. Matt Luther.
Thank you. Yeah, so obviously one of the six outcomes for the National Planning Framework is around health, public health. So that is to be welcomed. And obviously the framework itself is a fairly high level document, and I suppose sets the tone. But with these things, I guess the devil's always in the detail. And I know there's going to be guidance that's being developed that sits alongside it that maybe gets into the detail about how these things are going to play out. But I guess for me, the key question really we need to ask ourselves, and maybe this is a test, is if a local developer, sorry, if a local planner wants to refuse development on the basis of health, does this document, do these suite of documents allow them to do that? Because we know in the past that hasn't been the case. And for me, that's the critical question. And I know there's a requirement for the local development plans to conduct a health impact assessment, which again is to be welcomed. And I know major developments are going to be subject to health impact assessments, again, which is to be welcomed. But it doesn't really say much about, as I say, that level of decision making around actually basing decisions on the basis of health and approving or rejecting applications specifically on the basis of health. But I think if it could be quite detailed around that, I think that would be really helpful, and just make it really clear that if a local planning department or indeed a local public health team have concerns about a development that's not going to impact on health, you know, what is the mechanism for actually making that decision? So some clarity around that I think would be really helpful.
Okay.
Thank you.
I've got one brief wee supplementary, if that's okay. It's probably is for either Irene Buteman or Dr. Matt Lowther. I'm thinking about, like, one of our questions talks about whether it's sufficiently clear which developments generate significant health effects. And I'm thinking about how mental health and well-being can be impacted by living next to derelict buildings or vacant and abandoned land. And there is research that says that abandoned buildings and shops can make us feel unsafe, and rundown environments contribute to anxiety and low mood. So if we're trying to support planning to help mental health, should we be trying to expedite planning to deal with the derelict and vacant buildings that are affecting mental health as well? We've got a number of them across my region, Fistranraer, Dunbar, and you know, I'm thinking about the George Hotel in the town centre, for instance. So do we need to make sure that the developments generate significant health and wellbeing effects and then deal with the derelict buildings as well?
I'm not quite sure who would like to come in and talk about that specifically. Jamie either Pierce might be a good person to talk about that. I'll go to Jamie Pierce.
Yeah, I mean, I can really just support what you're saying, because there is evidence, including work in Scotland, that we know that derelicts and brownfield sites do have detrimental health impacts. That has been shown. It's also been shown very clearly in Scotland that crime and perceptions of crime are also closely linked to mental health. I do think this is a nice example of the way in which the planning system can bring forward those issues with a public health lens, very, very carefully focused on them, to ensure that the developmental needs also meet health needs. And that's where the framework, I think, does need to support that.
Okay, I'll come to Eileen Buteman.
Thank you. Yeah, definitely. I repeat what Jamie's just said there, and what you were referring to about the evidence of vacant and derelict land on mental health. But I would also go so far as to say most development has the potential to have a negative impact on mental health or physical health if it's a substantial size development. There is an opportunity there to make sure that the consequence of that development is considered in light of its impact on physical and mental health for different age groups as well, and particularly for our ageing population. I'm thinking about things like, you know, out of centre development. I'm thinking about housing development, a big aspect of what the MPF is there to deliver upon. If we are continuing building low density housing estates on the edge of town, where there's very few access to facilities without the reliance on a car, then we're building in inherent mental and physical health problems, particularly as people start to age in that area as well, but also for those that can potentially feel socially isolated because they're not out walking around building that community feeling and community cohesion. So I would say all large developments need to be thought through for their impact on physical and mental health.
Thank you. And Matt Lowther.
It's a good question. I would agree with Eileen and Jamie. All developments have the potential to impact on health. I guess the point I was specifically wanting to make was around this definition of a major development and versus a local development. So a lot of the focus, particularly around health inequality or health impact assessments, is on major developments and national developments. But we know the majority of developments are actually local developments, so that's developments below, I think, 50 homes, and they're really significant, you know, and there's, you know, literally hundreds of those across Scotland, and they really do have the potential to have an impact on health. And although, as I understand it, the policy only focuses on the major and national developments, so that, again, there seems to be a bit of a gap around those local developments. And as I say, the devil's in the detail with these things.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to panel members. Around local living, do you expect 20-minute neighbourhoods to have a significant positive impact on health and wellbeing? And if so, in what ways? And can I go to Dr. Matt Lowther, please?
So I guess In a word, yes. So again, really welcome the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods. You know, I think over the last couple of years, with our experience of COVID, just the power of living locally, I think, is really come through. As we were just talking about earlier, I think having good access, good quality access to good quality local services is really important for our health and wellbeing, and is really important for our communities. Anything that can increase our levels of physical activity and increase our social interaction, which is what 20-minute neighbourhoods can do, I think is really important for our health. There's obviously issues and some potential questions over how many of our communities can actually become a 20-minute neighbourhood. But I think the underlying principle of what the 20-minute neighbourhoods are trying to achieve is really good and really welcome from a health perspective, and that is just creating much better local access to the key quality services that people need on a daily basis.
Thank you. And can I come to Eileen?
Thank you. Yeah, I think they have one of the most noticed impact of realising living locally and the benefits of it that we've had in the public domain for quite some time. So totally welcome them. But we can look across other parts of the world to see what are the elements that they are including as being important and as a 20-minute neighbourhood. And I think we have an opportunity, given the National Planning Framework provides policy where we can immediately start to assess large applications. There's an opportunity to pin down those elements now. I have unfortunately seen already many communications where there are developments claiming to be 20-minute neighbourhoods because they have put in cycleways and they have one local shop. We're really talking about more than that. And if we don't pin that down, then we risk taking a planning system and certainly local government who are under-resourced at the moment to deal with the duties and responsibilities they have, and having fairly endless debates across other sectors about just what is a 20-minute neighbourhood. So support expressed in this national planning framework for them, but without saying exactly what is it that makes them 20-minute. Let's think about other aspects such as density of housing, such as people feeling they have a sense of control and influence and over the place outside their doorstep. This is about more than purely active travel, and we could spend an awful lot of time debating this and taking up a lot of planning officer time that they don't have, debating this even into inquiry and cost, where we could really pin this down. And that again was why we submitted in the place and wellbeing outcomes that we've looked at, we tested as the sort of wording that could pin down exactly what a 20-minute neighbourhood needs to be. And then everyone across Scotland is starting from the same standpoint. There's consistency and there's a comprehensive approach. And I think that would give a lot of confidence to all sectors taking part in the planning system.
Thank you. David, are you happy with that, or if you get anything else you want to ask?
One small supplementary, please. How will the benefits of 20-minute neighbourhoods be realised in more remote rural areas of Scotland? How can we achieve to get this? And I'll go to Dr. Mark Lowe-Leppard to start with again, please.
Eileen wanted to come in on that specifically, but I'll come to Dr. Lowther first.
So again, it's a good question in terms of the rurality aspect. I guess for me, it's about how we just encourage and improve our services in those communities so that we can make sure that people can access the services that they need, the daily services they need, on a daily basis. So for me, that's why I'm so drawn to the concept, because it is about trying to improve access to good quality services for everyone. And of course, we need to be realistic and pragmatic about it. Some of our rural communities are not going to be able to walk to all of our services within 20 minutes. So I don't think we should necessarily get too hung up on the 20-minute aspect of it. For me, it is really about improving the quality of access to the key local services. That's really what we should be aspiring to do.
Thank you. And I'll come to Eileen Buteman.
Thanks. Yeah, very good question, given how much of Scotland is covered by rural areas. And it is very much about, no matter where, you know, if you live in a house in its own in the countryside or a hamlet of 17 houses, you will relate to your nearest settlement. You will say, I live outside of. And it's making sure when you get to that nearest settlement that you get as much out of that place and what that place delivers that stops you having to go beyond and on to another settlement that's 50 or 100 miles away in order to meet your daily needs. So it's accepted that not everybody can have that on their doorstep, that 20-minute living. But when we come to rural areas, that local settlements are treated as 20-minute hubs and that we think of them like that. We don't think of them as places that then can spread and sprawl out because they're in the countryside, because they are the 20-minute neighbourhood hubs of the future and for the area around them. So we build the appropriate densities. We still look to provide all of the aspects of a 20-minute neighbourhood within those hubs so that people can choose to either live within them or to live without them. But once they get to them, they can park up that car that they've needed to get there and move around and access everything that they need in the same manner as you would do if you were living in a more urban environment. So I think there is a lot of opportunity to think about how we're developing those rural towns and to address that rural depopulation ask that's in the national planning framework.
And digging into the rural areas a little bit more deeply, we've got Sandesh Gohani. Sandesh?
Thank you, Convener. When housing developments are greenlit, there's an assessment to its impact to schools, but there's no assessment as to whether primary care can cope. We know there's a historical lack of staff in rural areas and a lack of homes and transport infrastructure makes it less likely to attract staff. So should this framework include an assessment of a minimum requirement for health and care services to be provided alongside new developments? And I have a supplementary after that. And so Professor Pearce, if I could ask you first.
I guess my response is that, you know, the range of services that a community needs to a healthy, fulfilling life, and certainly primary healthcare services is part of that. Now, I guess I would say that the national planning framework is the good intention would be to really look quite holistically across all those needs. And of course, those needs, sort of coming back to the previous question, in rural communities may look quite.
We appear to have lost Professor Pearce. Can I come to one of our other panellists first, while we maybe try and get him back? If we maybe come to Dr. Lowther first.
Yes, thank you. So I guess my response is, again, yes. I think the quality of services and the access to services is something that could be picked up through these health inequality impact assessments or health impact assessments. So when the LDP is being formed, you know, what the HIA can do is actually look and think about how the development and the planned developments can have an impact on health. And part of that is an assessment of access to services such as health and social care services. So, you know, through the provision of an HIA looking at LDPs, then I would hope that that would be picked up and taken into account.
Eileen Buteman.
Yeah, just quickly, the framework does mention about looking at the provision of health and social care facilities, and I think it's something that it could say a little more on about closer relationships with our health and social care partnership. In order to ensure that there is provision there. I know that in some councils across Scotland that happens, perhaps less better formed connections in others. And in my own experience of 28 years previously working as a town planner, a different set of approaches as to whether that was bottomed out before looking at the growth of a particular area. So it could be something that's in here about making sure that there's that kind of evidence looked at across working more closely and building relationship with the health and social care partnership to establish where there's capacity and where there's a need for a matching up of the provision to meet where an area is perhaps growing.
Sandesh?
Thank you, Convener. Sorry, I see that Professor Pearce is back.
Oh, Professor Pearce is back. Okay, if you, Sanders, if you want to ask a supplementary question, and then I'll come back to Professor Pearce first. He can round off what his points were earlier, and then address your supplementary, if that's okay.
Absolutely. So Irene was talking a little bit about this, but it's can we really use planning as a tool to improve health services, especially in our rural areas?
If we come back to Professor Pearce, we heard most of what you were saying. I think you just sort of dropped off at the end, so that's good you've been able to come back.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not quite sure when I got cut off there, but I was sort of making a case of sort of holistic approach to health services. And I think in rural areas, I mean, I think that on the points of around relating to 20 minutes, I see that more as a sort of principle and a metaphor. I think we should be applying that to our health services as well. You know, what are those services that we need? How do we make sure they're as accessible as possible to those communities? The spatial planning framework helps us do that because it does make us think about what it is we need within within reasonable access for our communities, and so I'm sure it'll be a helpful step towards that.
Thank you. And can I come to Irene?
Yeah, thank you. I think we can, yes. I think what we've just been talking about with the role of 20-minute neighbourhoods in local living would mean that part of looking at our existing areas and any future new areas, that we make sure that there is that access to those daily, weekly needs of, you know, not your hospitals and so on, but that access to health services can be planned in as you're moving forward. And again, that's closer links with health and social care partnerships to ensure that's happening. There's frequently a breakdown of sending a local development plan off to your director of public health and your health and social care partnership once it's been prepared. Yet there's so many councils doing great work who are talking to them upfront and planning around what's already there and thinking and taking that into account. And the emphasis on local living and local facilities, I think, can only prove to support that as we move forward.
And can I come to Dr. Lowther?
So territorial boards are, I guess, key agencies and are required to be consulted on in relation to local development plans. So as Irene was saying, I think that making sure that relationship is strong right at the beginning, so that when we are producing our local development plans, we are doing it in light of what are the health and social care needs of our populations right at the beginning. So for me, it's about making sure those connections are strong right at the beginning of the process.
That's great. Can I move on to talking about health inequalities and Sue Webber? Sue.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in some of your comments about the 20-minute neighbourhood being more than about active travel. So I was wanting to ask, in your mind, does the National Planning Framework 4 account for the needs and experiences of disabled people in Scotland? Because I know that with the 40 kilometres of segregated cycle lanes that have been put down in Edinburgh under the premise of spaces for people, that's caused a lot of concern for disabled people and those with mobility issues in Edinburgh. So what can be done to build more inclusive settlements going forward?
Great question. Maybe go to Dr. Lowther first.
Yeah, it's a great question. Again, I guess, as I said earlier, the devil is in the detail with these things. So I think when we're starting to provide the guidance that sits alongside how NPF4 is going to be implemented, then it needs to be really clear about how developments can be produced in a way that is accessible and truly accessible for all of our communities. And as I say, the document at the moment doesn't say a huge amount about that. So I think that that's really an area that it potentially could be strengthening. And potentially as well, I think you talked as well or mentioned inequalities. So I think there's a real opportunity for the planning system to really have a real impact on health inequalities. And we'll maybe come on and touch on that later in the session. But yeah, so I think The guidance that sits alongside this is going to be really critical in terms of getting that right to make sure that it really is truly accessible.
Can I just add in a little bit?
Sure.
Yeah, it was just because where I struggle a bit, Dr. Lowther, and maybe the next contributor can address this, is that all the documents go from walking to wheeling. There's an awful lot happens before someone walks and ends up in a wheelchair. And I really, really struggle with that, you know, and it doesn't seem to allow for those that are striving to walk and want to get out. But you understand where my approach is, where my thoughts are? Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess that's what I was trying to say, when we really need to be really clear about this with the guidance that sits alongside it. So, you know, how can we really make sure it is? And for me, this comes back to the whole idea of health inequality impact assessments, not just health impact assessments. So that's the whole idea of a health inequality impact assessment, is that these things, and there's tools and guidance that allow us to do this. We can very, very specifically look at these sorts of policies and think about how they will impact on all of our communities. That's why I would particularly push for health inequality impact assessments as well as health impact assessments, because I think they will pick up those sorts of things.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Eileen Buterman?
Thank you. Yeah, and it's precisely because of this that I can be known to rant a little bit about using the term 20-minute neighbourhoods and folk going on and on about 20 minutes, because it is about different population groups and it is about people walking and travelling through their urban and the rural places at different paces, and we need to take account of that. And the place and wellbeing outcomes that we've inputted into the process so far, we're very clear at the end of that we have to see that through the lens of all of our different population groups, and that includes different mobility abilities almost, and how people can be moving. And also, though, touches in more so on what Matt was saying also about other groups in our population, and considering how we deliver places with an eye on all of those different aspects of a population. That's why we really need to be talking local living, because it isn't just about some arbitrary number of minutes, although that has captured the attention. And where we've used those place and wellbeing outcomes to assess a place and how it's moving forward, we have run it through the lens of not just the national outcomes and the place and wellbeing outcomes, but all of those different population groups, including changing mobility, particularly because of our ageing population. So I think we do need more on that, and I would certainly like to just see it now, because then planning authorities can, as I say, hit the ground running and assessing this and getting that change to happen now.
Thank you. Sue, have your questions been answered?
I've got one more question, convener. And again, Eileen alluded to this as well, in terms of one of the stated aims around the planning framework is about increasing the density of settlements. But we've known through the pandemic as well that the valuableness of our green spaces in our urban areas. So how is that going to be balanced a bit more with the need to support active travel and public transport while protecting our green spaces, which might be the spaces that are used to create those active travel routes, etc.?
We go back to Eileen on that.
Not sure. Professor Pierce, maybe?
We'll go to Eileen first. Town planner hat on.
Thank you. Yeah, density is really important, but it doesn't have to be a huge increase in density. We're not talking up to high density. We're just talking about pulling away from the sorts of detached large villa sprawl that we are tending to see around most of our towns in Scotland at the moment, that don't enable us to live more densely, to walk more, to support a local shop. You need a certain number of households and population to do that. And if we wish people to go and use that shop, then we need things just a little bit closer together in order to achieve that. So that is talking about a mix of types of housing, of having terraced, of having colonies, of having flats, of making more use of lower lower ground floor flats for our ageing population. If we think about many of the great places in cities, I'm sitting in Edinburgh, and it's places that have a mix of big, large villas in with tenements, in with colonies, you know, in with semi-detached, and achieving more of that mix, but always, yes, still having access to open space being absolutely crucial, that it's not at the cost to that. It's at the cost to just building individual blocks all the time that aren't necessarily what our housing needs are actually as we move forward with an ageing population anyway. They just tend to be what, when we rely on the private sector, what they tend to make the most profit for their shareholder out of. And that's what that's their business model, and that's absolutely fine. But it isn't always then meeting what's the greatest place that we're creating. So it's both of them, and it's just a change in the uniform spread that we can tend to see.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions on conflicting interests from Gillian Mackay? Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. Does the panel recognise that there are conflicting Scottish Government aims and ambitions highlighted by the framework? For example, how does the action to support the whisky industry in order to provide sources of local employment line up with the public health aim to reduce alcohol consumption? And this could equally be applied to other areas that we've spoken about in terms of road building and things in other sectors and their impact on public health. Does the panel feel that public health should be prioritised over some of these other aims? And could I go to probably Dr. Lowther first?
Thank you.
Yeah, it's a very difficult question to answer. And because we know that economic investment is incredibly important and actually has public health outcomes as well. And so it's difficult to provide, I guess, a definitive response. From my perspective, from coming back to I guess the area that I'm particularly responsible for, it's about places. It's about creating the right places, and part of that is about creating economic investment. So of course that's really, really important. And I guess it's also making sure that all of these decisions are based on the evidence and based on the science, so we can model how these things potentially impact on public health. So for me, it's about taking a proper evidence-based approach to these decisions. And they're very difficult decisions, as I say, because we know that economies are so important for local public health outcomes. So apologies, we didn't answer that question definitively, but it's just not a simple response.
That's great, thanks, Convener. That's me.
We seem to have lost the convener. Paul?
I think we're coming on to my questions anyway, which is maybe neatly timed. So I'll maybe kick off this section where we're looking at national development. And I suppose I just kind of wanted to reflect on the fact that, you know, within the national developments of NPFO, there are 18 national developments. That seems to me like quite a lot, and I think very often these things can become quite cumbersome. So I would just be keen to understand what kind of impact do we feel that those 18 are going to have on health and wellbeing? And I'll maybe start with Dr. Lowther.
As part of the process for developing the NPF4, so we did an evidence assessment that looked at the potential for these national developments and how they impact on health. And I guess we concluded that all of the potential developments or the national developments do have the potential to impact on health. So from that perspective, from a public health perspective, you know, I think the developments have, I guess, do have the potential to have an impact on health. In terms of the actual number, again, that's a difficult question, I guess, to answer. You know, I've only looked at the individuals, you know, as individual developments. And as I say, I'm fairly comfortable and quite positive about what they say around health impacts.
Okay. I'm not seeing in the chat any other panelists wanting to come in at this stage. I'll maybe just move that question along a bit, just on those sorts of national developments. You know, should the impact on health and wellbeing be given equal consideration to, for example, the impact on the climate and indeed the climate emergency? Because we know that there's a huge amount of focus on that at the moment. I can see Irene Buteman will bring you in at this stage.
Thank you. I think the impact of the national developments, of the policy, of the strategy, in every case, we need to be looking at the impact on both and achieving that triple win that we keep talking about at the moment. That when we're looking to do something that is focusing on climate, and the MPF is quite clear that that's its primary guiding principle is around climate, that we make sure that we're not having unintended consequences that are negative on health, that we can achieve them both. So I think it's more important that we work in collaboration to make sure that we're delivering on them all. It shouldn't be at the cost of one or the other, or prioritising one or the other. I believe we can be doing both of them if we give ourselves a little bit of time to collaborate and talk through around knowing what it is we need to achieve in those places and how we can do both.
Thank you. And I think Jamie Pearce wanted to come in just on these issues as well. Jamie?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I mean, I very much agree with what Irene was saying there. I just perhaps would also add, I guess, applying a public health perspective onto the 18 national developments, I guess the question that arises to me is, you know, how were those chosen? And it comes back to your supplementary point there of making sure health is a key principle there. If health was a key principle in terms of selecting those 18 national developments, it was good to know how those decisions have arrived, and perhaps being slightly sceptical, maybe health wasn't a key principle in deciding upon them. So I guess for me, it sort of comes back to our conversation right at the start of the committee meeting, that we make sure that health is up there as, you know, one of the key strategic drivers here, and that we think through the benefits of health and wellbeing inequalities in a forensic way and target them throughout each of those national developments.
Thank you very much. The convener is just in the process of rebooting, so we'll continue with myself as vice convener. We're going to move on now to questions from Stephanie Callaghan, and Stephanie is going to look at outcomes. Stephanie.
Thank you, Paul. Earlier on, Irene already mentioned the work that the Improvement Service and Public Health have done around spatial planning, health and wellbeing outcomes. So really to pick up on that there. So to ask you, Irene, how can the outcomes proposed there be embedded in the framework so that they're going to be consistently used?
Yeah, so where we already have a set of policies in part three of the National Planning Framework, the place and wellbeing outcomes provide an awful lot more clarity than what is given at the moment within those sets of wordings. We have aspects like Policy 6 talks about, you know, the design and the quality of a place. I think that is absolutely crucial. I think we could be using the place and wellbeing outcomes wording itself to give much more clarity on what are the consistent, comprehensive things that we need to be considering in order to make sure that everybody is starting with from the same hymn sheet, essentially, rather than debating it over time. So that is where they can be embedded into that policy. At the moment, we have wordings of things like sense of joy and a feeling to want to play. And those aren't wordings that planning officers actually determining major applications for change in areas can use. They need actual wording that can enable them to confidently make decisions. They need that backed up with evidence about the inequalities, the health inequalities in an area as well. But very much they need that confidence of wording established now in the national planning framework. My memory back when we began this process was that the national planning framework would take a lot of the burden off local development plans by putting a lot of the policy once for Scotland up there nationally, that then could be used so that we could be producing slimmer and more agile local development plans in order to speed things up and move things on. And I just don't think that the level of clarity that is sitting in the national planning framework at the moment could be used like that. And that's certainly what I'm hearing from others across the board. So taking the wording as a very strong example of what we could be doing would be beneficial, and seeing if that needs augmented into the specific interventions that would need to be taken in order to deliver on those place and wellbeing outcomes. I think what's important is if you looked at every local development plan across Scotland right now, it would have some of those elements in them, but it wouldn't consistently have them. And it also has, from my own experience talking to planning officers across Scotland, because we support them with a planning skills series and we support heads of planning as well, is that they frequently don't have the confidence to apply them. Back to what Matt was saying earlier, they didn't feel they had the teeth to confidently say, look, you're not providing a good density with good quality open space, and you know all of the elements that we need, that we know we need to create a really successful place. You're not doing it, so we're going to turn you down. And where councils have built a reputation of doing that, they can eventually start to make a turn in the kind of applications that are coming into them. But that takes time, and that's what concerns me, is you know, we need to get going now. So embedding that kind of wording and that quality would enable us to do that now.
That's really helpful. Thanks, Irene. And I should say, actually, I'm a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council still currently as well. No longer on the planning committee, but I was previously there too. OK, to just follow that up, convener, with another short question there.
Yeah, sorry, I'll just step in at this point and say the convener's now with us again. So after my 5 minutes of fame, I will pass back to convener.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you. Stephanie, before you ask your question, Dr. Lowther and Professor Pearce wanted to come in your initial question. Can I bring in Dr. Lowther first, please?
Yeah, thanks. So just very quickly on top of what Irene has just described, what the health and wellbeing outcomes allow us to do is very clearly describe what a healthy, sustainable place looks like in its totality. And I don't think that that's really clear in any of the documentation that has been produced. So the health and wellbeing outcomes are very, very clear. If you want to produce a healthy, sustainable place, these are the 14 things that actually that place needs to achieve. It's really clear in that respect. So I think there is an opportunity to embed those place and wellbeing outcomes in the guidance that's being produced and consulted on at the moment around LDPs. So potentially in one of the annex, we could list those outcomes just so that local planners, so that local developers, you know, those involved in the planning system can really properly understand what a healthy, sustainable place looks like.
Thank you. Professor Pearce.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Just to add that I think it's important that these are tied to the ways in which the planning framework can affect health, very, very concrete pathways. And so, for example, obesity might be one that is identified. Important, I think, we think about the pathways. So one of the pathways might be about improving access to nutritious food. That might be one way we capture it, as well as the health outcome, which might be reducing obesity levels amongst school-aged children. You know, that would be an obvious example. I think it's just important to think through the steps and stages through which the planning system can affect it and the strength of evidence connecting the two, and make sure that's informing whatever those outcomes are.
Thank you. Stephanie.
That's great. Thanks very much to all of you there. Now, earlier on, we had Dr. Booth and Jacqueline Lynn. I don't know if you were all here for the beginning of the committee, for the first panel that we had there. And they mentioned and really stressed the need for infrastructure for women and young girls to be able to be active in their communities and feel safe when they're out in the community. And I'm wondering if you feel that that's something that's been adequately addressed, or if there should be some more focus there. Thanks.
Thank you.
And again, I go to Irene. Yes, thanks.
Thank you. I think that comes back to just what I was saying earlier about mobility as well, is that when we're looking at any proposal for change, any major proposal for change, we need to be running it through the lens of different population groups. And that's why at the bottom of the Place and Wellbeing Outcomes, it lists those population groups, one being women, one being young people, because I think it is crucial we know that open spaces require a different set of requirements if we're going to get young girls in particular to take part, because they have a different set of asks from that place. So we need to be considering that, and we need to also, and this comes to comments that are made within the policies about equalities as well, where it says, you know, we need to talk to communities in an appropriate and I can't remember the other word, manner. We really need to be finding, making sure that we're talking to all parts of communities, or talking to our community planning colleagues who are aware of all parts of communities and their needs as well. So it is an important aspect. It comes back to that wellbeing economy measure, doesn't it, of Catherine Trebeck, about 12-year-old girls being able to cycle to school as a way of monitoring the success of a country rather than it being purely about GDP. So yeah, absolutely crucial.
Thank you. I did promise if we had time at the end that I would allow Emma to come back in for her very targeted and very brief supplementary. Emma, you wanted to ask Dr. Lowther a question.
Yep, thanks very much, convener, for indulging you. It is for Dr. Matt Lowther. He's mentioned the PLACE standard too, and Matt Lowther describes the 14 questions in this framework that aims to let communities and public agencies and voluntary groups find aspects of a place to target the health and well-being and the quality of life. So this tool, how do we know that people are aware of it and that they're using it? Because yesterday I called Dumfries and Galloway Planning Department and they weren't aware of the tool, but they were certainly going to look into it. So how do we ensure that tools like this that can support better planning for public health are available and are used?
So thank you. So that actually surprises me, because we know that every local authority now is using the PLACE standard tool. We have a national alliance that brings together people using the tool. We have representatives in each of the local authority areas that we engage with about the PLACE standard tool. It's used, you know, it's been used literally hundreds of times across Scotland. We've got a very accessible website. We've had international recognition for the PLACE standard tool. It's used in, you know, literally dozens of other countries. So that's not to say that obviously we can rest on our laurels. Of course, we'll always need to do more. So if there's something that you specifically think that we need to do to get that message out there, if people don't think that, you know, that message isn't getting out there, then of course that's something that we specifically can look at. But as I say, I am quite surprised in that, because as I say, I know that we do have a national alliance and we do have contact with all our local authorities and they're all using it. So that surprises me.
That's good to hear. It was only one person I spoke to, yeah. So it might be worth me certainly following up on a wider area as well.
Thank you very much. I want to thank our three panellists for their time this morning. Very interesting discussion and has given us a lot to think about. But that's the end of that session. At our next meeting on the 1st of February, the committee will take evidence from the Scottish Government on part of our inquiry into health and wellbeing of children and young people. And we'll also take evidence on two common frameworks. But that does complete the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.